WWF Retro Raw number 341, December 6th, 1999. New Age Outlaws versus Too Cool. So the Outlaws come out.
First off, what the hell's up with Too Cool coming out to Public Enemy's music?
I noticed that too. That's weird.
You don't say? Like, they're trying to dance later on to that fucking song. That did not work.
Yeah.
That was a failure. Hopefully it's a one-week aberration. They thought, I got better music for you. Bust out that Public Enemy music. And they listened to it and realized it was shit. Went back to the other bad song.
Oh, it's a much better
song. Which was catchy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the New Age Outlaws, they're buddies with Hunter, who's the top heel. They hang out with him. They do all this dirty work. They're his thugs. They come out here. They do the PG version of their promo. Everyone cheers along. And then in this match, I'm pretty sure they were the babyfaces.
First off, this was the week where, like, the... I don't remember exactly what happened. Maybe it was the Parents' Television Council, or there was a bunch of controversy or something, but a whole bunch of sponsors pulled out.
Mm.
So they claim they are now PG.
I see.
Which, by the way, this is the end of 1999. They're now PG. So for everybody that cries about the PG era Raw and how, oh my God, once it went PG, it was all downhill. The year 2000 is their biggest year of all time ever.
Yes.
Which apparently is PG because they moved to PG this week.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't want to hear that bullshit excuse anymore. But yeah, they had a very, very PG Outlaws promo.
Mm-hmm.
Although later in the show, Triple H referenced the fans calling Stephanie a slut and a whore.
Yes.
We had half-naked hoes.
Yeah.
And a couple of other things as well. I believe Hunter said shit at one point.
Somebody did. I remember that.
Yeah, it was Hunter.
So they get the heat on Road Dogg. He makes a comeback where he makes Grandmaster Sexay look like a complete fool. And then Too Cool has a visual pin over the World Tag Team Champions when the Hollies attack for the DQ on somebody.
Yeah, they run in, and then Rikishi runs in, and then Hardcore gives him a DDT on a chair, and Jerry Lawler asks, and I quote, is this over or what? And then they rang the bell.
Yes.
So I guess it was over.
An inauspicious start.
I don't know what the referee was doing where he didn't know that it was over, but he didn't.
A limousine arrives. It's Stephanie. She makes sure the driver will stay there, which turned out to be pointless. On SmackDown, they showed her making Vince and Shane promise they would let her handle her new marriage to Hunter Hearst Helmsley.
That's right. Vince and Shane not happy. She says, I've got to hold on to one shred of integrity. You'll see.
It's gone.
We'll all see.
Mankind comes out for a promo. His book is number one now.
Yes.
And they take shots at all the snooty book critics who won't even review it. So he had footage of Al Snow and the New Age Outlaws attacking The Rock on SmackDown.
Definitely a heel turn.
I guess. So Snow comes out. He's all angry. He says the fans don't care about Mankind. They'll forget his book and remember him more for going off a cage. He was half right.
Actually, he wasn't even half right because, like, I think the number one thing that people remember Mick Foley for is being thrown off the cell.
Yes.
And I think the number two thing is he wrote that book.
Right. So he's
and opened the floodgates. So he's wrong. They remembered him for both of these things.
I see. Because he said yes. Only remember you.
Yes, he was wrong.
Well, they remember him most for going off the cage. So I'll give him credit for that one.
Yeah.
He says people don't give a damn about Mick. Rocky doesn't either. He's cutting this passionate, angry promo about how I believe this man was hurt and he's betrayed by his close friend Mick Foley.
Yeah, clearly.
And then he's got help me written backwards on his forehead.
Well, he's a little bit crazy.
Just ruined the whole thing.
But he didn't have the head.
Did not have head.
He came out without the head.
No.
He didn't do any stupid comedy. He came out there and he was very, very angry and he made sense in his promo.
Mm-hmm.
He's trying to explain that he's Mick's friend.
Yes.
And so he wants him to stop doing this comedy.
Mm-hmm.
And then Mick's pretty much explaining, I'm not getting hurt right now.
Yeah.
I'm having fun with The Rock, and nobody's getting killed.
Yeah.
Al does not want to hear this. This is the hardcore legend Mick Foley.
This is the same promo that Joey Ryan cuts on Jim Cornette.
Basically. About how he's making money to not get hurt, and everyone's happy with it.
Yeah.
Yeah. So Mankind says, I'm friends with Gerald Briscoe. I'm friends with Joe C., who used to rap with Kid Rock back in the day. But I don't want to work with them.
Joe C., whatever happened. He died, right?
I believe he passed away.
Yeah.
Yeah. Says, I'm friends with them, but I don't want to work with them. I like teaming with The Rock. He outright says, I never get hurt. Yeah, I play the fool, but I like it. Rock likes it. The fans like it. And Al Snow and Mankind, he says, sucked.
Well, He's not wrong.
Did you also notice that Mankind cut a promo? When he was cutting his promo, he mentioned, I haven't got a concussion in months.
Yes. That's news.
Yeah. We didn't know about concussions back then, Brian.
Yeah. We didn't know they were bad, apparently. We knew they existed.
I see.
Al challenges Mankind to a tag match, him and Rock against Alan, a mystery partner. And Al says, my feelings were very hurt by all those jokes you said about me in the book, and I am the one who threw it in the trash. And they got into a brawl, and Geeks broke it up.
Man, after all that, it was Al Snow.
Who could have thunk it?
Who could have seen that one coming?
Amazing.
What an asshole.
He is an asshole.
He is an asshole. He was awesome, though.
This was a good
segment. Last 2 weeks have been the very best of Al Snow.
That's fair.
Like, I watched this, and I thought, you know, I'd do something with Al Snow. Not a lot.
Really, this whole thing since you started teaming with...
Yeah.
The promo where he introduced him and brought him as his partner.
He is
a
character of value in this promotion now.
Yes, which is
unlike
remarkable.
Before. Yeah. Yes.
Steph tells Vince she wants to do things her way. She promises she will provoke Hunter. Yeah. The Hardy Boys versus Kurt Angle and Steve Blackman.
She says, I'm going to handle it my way because I know at Armageddon, you're going to take care of him. That's what she said. Mm-hmm. They're having a match.
Yes, Vince and Hunter is the main event.
Yes.
Vince McMahon in the main event of a pay-per-view. So Hardy Boys versus Kurt Angle and Steve Blackman.
He's main evented before.
I'm
saying
sure
Valentine's Day Massacre. And
That's true, yeah. So Angle does a promo to start. He's actually fighting Blackman at the pay-per-view this Sunday. But they're teaming up here, and he... It's a great promo about how if you do what I say, you're going to be a star. Blackman's entrance is interrupted by a mysterious orange and black tattoo symbol.
Hmm. 13.
13, yes.
Who could that be?
We'll find out at the Rumble, I think. So.
Is it the Rumble?
I think
so. It's the Rumble.
Yeah. Didn't he wrestle Kurt before that?
No.
Okay.
I think he wrestled him at the Rumble.
Yeah.
Well, there you go.
As a surprise opponent, I believe. Yes. Everyone knew who it was. So, let's see. The match begins. It's only like 10 seconds, but for those 10 seconds when Kurt Angle tears Jeff Hardy apart, it's just glorious. Just throws him around, ducks behind him, takes him down, smothers him. It's awesome. Let's see. There's a spot where...
Oh, I love this. So the Hardys are running wild.
Yeah.
Jeff hits a senton. They go for Air Hardy. Is that what they call it? Air Hardy.
Poetry in motion.
Poetry in motion, yeah. Whatever. So he goes for it, and the spot is... Blackman whacks him with a kendo stick out of midair.
Oh, there's that. Okay, you're talking about something else, yeah.
Okay, well, he whacks him with his kendo stick shot, which leads to Angle getting the pin.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, even though he hit him in midair, Jeff's body still flung through the air and smashed into Kurt Angle, who proceeds to not sell it, and then hit the Angle slam for the pin.
Are you talking about the spot where Blackman whips Matt Hardy in?
Yes.
Matt, for whatever reason, just hit the deck.
Well, I watched this about 5 times because I thought somebody tripped him.
Here's what I got out of it.
Okay.
The spot was Blackman whips him in. Hardy slides underneath a kick.
Yes.
Because they went right back to it.
Yes.
Right after that.
Yes. So but
Matt looked like a complete idiot.
Correct.
Like he just fell on the mat.
Yes.
But in fact,
a gravity storm hit him.
It was Blackman's fault.
Yes. Blackman did not throw the kick. So when Matt went to duck it, there's nothing to duck under and he just collapsed to the mat.
I hate that.
Oh, so yeah, Terry takes the ref, Blackman hits a stick shot, and Kurt and Steve win. Stephanie asks Hunter to sign annulment papers. They're in the locker room. X-Pac's response to this is to make jokes about gangbanging her in the shower.
Yeah.
She appeals to Hunter as a human being looking for a shred of decency. And they look at each other, and they laugh at her. And she storms out, frustrated. And Hunter, I believe, was down with this gangbang idea.
Yes, he was.
Yeah, he says, in all seriousness, are we in the shower or not?
Yeah.
So then he says, listen, the least I can do is look at him. I'm not such a bad guy. How about you give me a shot of that? Tried to hump her on the way out.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't work.
Well, tried to play nice guy?
But he did agree to look at the papers.
Yes, yes.
Maybe he thought, if I look at these papers, she'll allow me to have sex with her.
Well.
Didn't work.
After I've insulted her and...
Yeah.
Said all my friends.
This show's now PG too.
I guess so, yeah.
Now the WWE has changed.
Val Venus versus D'Lo Brown, with the winner being the top contender
to the British Bulldog?
To the European title.
What?
So they wrestle, and the posse and the bulldog attack both
dudes.
When
the fuck were the posse and the British bulldog a crew?
They just started hanging out together.
It was like 2 weeks ago.
Fuck, I have no memory of this. I mean, I know it happened 2 weeks ago, but I don't remember it ever happening before, ever.
I gotcha.
Forget when it started in this dimension. When I grew up, they were never a crew.
Sounds better.
It's a different timeline.
So they destroy Val and D'Lo. I assume this leads to a three-way. And somewhere in here, Rodney hit the scariest blockbuster of all time. Did look out of control and reckless.
Mm-hmm.
Mae Young and Moolah.
They're going to be in the Billboard Music Awards.
To be in the Billboard Music Awards. Mae Young pours one out for her homies. Says word. Asks where her dog's at.
Yeah.
And Moolah calls her a crazy old cracker.
That all happened.
Yeah.
Sounded like you reviewing one of these shows.
Even cooler, they were, though.
Yeah.
Yeah. DX looks at the paperwork as promised. Godfather versus Prince Albert. These hosses.
Okay, I listen. I thought this was a hoss battle. I was wrong. We had a real hoss battle later on in the show.
Yeah.
This was I don't know, two fairly large animals. Not quite hosses. Maybe two sheep.
What?
You know, a little.
You ever seen a sheep?
Well, like a real big one. I'm looking for a big animal that's smaller than like a big horse.
Horse?
A mule.
Yeah, a mule. It's a mule fight.
A mule fight.
Yeah, that's a good one. Two mules. Two mules kicking at each other.
There is a bigger match later. That's true.
Yes, much bigger.
The point is, they're big people.
They're very large.
They get in there and they're just running for miles. They're running here and there, hitting the ropes, hitting the corner, back and forth, back and forth. Eventually, the Godfather hits the Ho Train, which is an avalanche, and a schoolboy, and he gets the win, and everyone cheers.
Yeah.
Great!
You know, rewinding, Prince Albert was in this match. I think your goat analogy was actually good, because Prince Albert is awful furry.
Yes, he is.
Mm. I mean, so is a donkey. Just different kind of.
No one shears a donkey.
No one shears a donkey.
Llamas! That's what they were. They were llamas.
Two big llamas.
Or alpacas.
Ostriches.
You can shear
No
them.
One uses ostrich fur. They don't have fur. They have
feathers. They don't have fur, but I'm just talking about two big angry animals.
Well, he's talking about them being hairy.
Okay.
So, yeah, they're all pockets.
Two small bears.
Prince Albert's definitely a bear. That's a fact. Hunter has flowers. And then we later found out... he broke Greg.
Why is that so funny?
I don't think he's gay.
I didn't say he was gay.
He said he was a bear.
That's the body type.
I know, I'm just kidding.
So Hunter has flowers, and he comes out, he does his promo, has the whole big, angry Triple H promo where he gets in the apron and he spits the water, but he's doing it with the flowers in his hand.
Yeah.
Which makes it better. So he talks about the horrible names the fans have been calling Steph at SmackDown, blames the fans for Stephanie's annulment papers, rambles on for a while, and finally says, if she wants me to sign, coming out and I'll sign those papers. Steph comes out, she's not buying his act, throws the flowers into the crowd.
It's giving him the face.
The Stephanie face?
Yeah.
So now Hunter says she is too hot to annul the marriage. Says life would not be the same without her. And I'm watching this. In 1999, it's like the bad guy wrestler and the boss of the daughter doing a part on the show. When you watch it in 2018, it's a future husband and wife.
Yeah.
Doing this weird shit where they're having a fucked up marriage.
Yes.
It's bizarre.
Have you ever watched wrestling before? It's happened a million times in a million different territories.
I suppose.
Hunter says, well, first off, she's they're going on, and she says, I hope Vince cripples you at Armageddon.
She's definitely Vince McMahon's daughter, because she says, you're a son of a bitch.
And Hunter says, you might be onto something here. He says, if that old goat.
Vince is the goat.
If that old goat can beat me at Armageddon, I'll sign these damn papers. If your dad... Oh, shit. If my dad beat me at Armageddon, I'll sign these papers. Everybody laughs, howling at all of this. And I guess the stipulation is if he beats Vince, he gets a championship match.
Mm-hmm.
If he loses to him, he says, I'm going to accept this provision the old way. I'm old school. He grabs her and he kisses her on the lips and the crowd gasps.
Yes.
And Vince does a son of a bitch face.
Yes.
This was awesome. Mega heat.
This was long, but it was very good.
This was a good show.
This was like the best Raw in a long time.
Looking back at it here, yeah. Thank God they went to PG.
Yes.
Seems like it's a lot better that way, everyone.
So Vince is fuming. The Stooges are trying to calm him down. Mankind, who has not been friendly with Vince for a long time, Mick Foley shows up and says, listen, I have a daughter. can't imagine what you're going through, but I do know something about hardcore wrestling. If you want some tips, I can help you out.
Yeah, the best thing about this is Vince is backstage. He's all mad. Foley walks up. Foley says his deal. You can hear Foley, but he's facing Vince, who's facing kind of a little bit towards us. It felt real.
Yeah.
Because these two shitheads weren't facing the fucking camera.
Right.
Side to side next to each other, hip to hip.
Yes.
Looking straight on, dead straight forward, but not at the camera, and acting. Why don't they just do this again? Why can't they just do that?
Because it's a bad show now.
Did they watch it and go, oh, can't really hear what Mick's saying. Should have been facing the fucking camera. Then from then on, they all have to face the camera like fucking weirdos.
I don't know what to tell you, man.
I want it to be real. Even though it's
not.
I
do too!
Jesus Christ.
Yeah, if it was real, Vinny would keep watching.
If it was real, my voice wouldn't crack like that.
That's not a guarantee.
That's not, actually. You never know what... Anyway. Hardcore Holly versus Rikishi Fatu. Why is this name so hard for Jim Ross to say?
Some words are hard for people to say, Vinny.
So, Too Cool's on commentary. If you ain't cool, they say, you're a mofo.
Yeah.
Okay.
They're awesome. It's my favorite act right now.
So, Rikishi wins with the Yokozuna splash in like 15 seconds.
I was going to say, did I miss something or did this go? I started writing shit down and I looked up and it was over.
That's what happened.
It was like some sort of glitch.
Nope.
Bob Holly got squashed.
Yeah. And then Rikishi and Too Cool danced and everyone loved them. As my notes here read, Nurse BB puts lotion on her breasts.
I wrote Nurse BB was putting something all over her boobs.
It was glitter.
Mmm.
So we're all right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I just want to make sure that's I didn't miss anything or I wasn't being lewd. It's just an explanation of what was on TV.
She comes down to the ring for an interview with Michael Cole, and she's interrupted by Ivory. And Ivory is literally cutting a promo. There's no innuendo.
No.
She's like, look at the size of your tits.
I wrote her down.
They're gigantic.
She said, quote, your boobs really are quite enormous. It's a direct line.
Yeah.
So they are out here, BB and Ivory, to promote a Four Corners evening gown match.
Yes.
Yes.
They don't know who the other two people are.
Not yet.
No.
No. Ivory, make sure to mention your breasts are so gigantic that if you could produce milk, you could feed half the world.
Yes.
These are the fighting words for this evening gown match.
They are. So she promises to take pleasure in stripping her. At this point, Jacqueline interrupts. Her interruption is interrupted by the mysterious orange and black 13 tattoo.
She no-sells it.
She does. She calls Ivory Big Mouth.
Yeah.
That's fighting words.
Yeah.
So Ivory demands to know.
Clearly in the original script it was bitch.
Probably.
But then they had to change it, so it became Big Mouth.
Yeah.
Because she said it like...
like a bad edit on network
Shut
TV.
Up, Big Mouth. That's literally what she said. Just like that.
I forget what movie it was, but there was, the line in the movie is, nobody fucks with me. Or nobody fucks around with me. And we're watching my sisters and I on TV.
Ferret?
No, it's changed to, nobody plays with me. Because they stretched it out for over fucks around. Anyway, the fourth contender out comes China. And Ivory's horrified. But China says, no, it's not me. I have another match. The fourth participant will be Miss Kitty.
Yeah.
And Miss Kitty says, China, I can't do this. And China says, you'll be in a match where you're stripped to your bra and panties. And Kitty says, I can't do that. I don't wear underwear. Like, ever, apparently. She can't put some on for this match.
Nope.
No.
No.
It's a rule.
Yeah.
So China just says, you'll just have to win. And they walk away, and Jim Ross says, remember, everyone, that's on pay-per-view. Like, outright saying, if you buy this, you might get nudity.
Yeah. Of course.
There's basically a 3 out of 4 chance, because I assume...
I mean, we don't.
I assume it's elimination. I don't know. So, the
Is it for the women's title?
I assume.
I think Miss Kitty wins.
Is it that match?
I don't know, but I know that she becomes the champion here before too long. Miss Kitty.
She's not there for long.
No.
And somewhere between now and her disappearance, she does get naked on pay-per-view. And she does win the title.
All the way naked?
Topless.
Topless.
I don't remember this.
Yeah, it was...
You remember Miss Kitty being topless on pay-per-view?
No, I remember Jackie.
Oh, that happened all the time.
That happened earlier, yeah.
Yeah.
This is after that, obviously.
Hmm. It was like a... it was either a mud...
Yeah, I remember it being some kind of mud or gravy match, whatever the hell they did.
I don't think this one's a gravy match.
But yes, Miss Kitty's breasts did appear on pay-per-view for, you know, half a second or whatever. So the Haas fight, Brian was referencing earlier.
Oh! It's started backstage.
Big Show and Viz. Godzilla and Kong are having a brawl backstage.
Fuck.
By the way, yeah, he's not Viz anymore. Everyone just calls him Viz.
He's Big Viz. It's Big Show and Big Viz.
Yeah.
So somehow Big Show ends up on a table.
A strong table.
I have no idea fucking how.
Yeah.
And Big Viz goes and he gives him a big splash through the table. And the fucking camera like missed all of it.
Yep.
I'm like, you've got the Big Show and Big Viz, and Big Viz is gonna he's gonna splash him through a table backstage on a cement, and you fucking can't get a shot of this.
Well, they were, as I recall, they were really, really close.
Yes, he was really tied in on the shot.
So back the fuck up, yeah,
yes,
or something.
Yes.
Jesus Christ.
Yes,
I'd have been so mad if I were either one of these guys.
Speaking of guys who I'd be mad if I was them.
Oh my God.
Triple H, Next Pac versus Kane and poor Test.
This was literally the follow-up to the wedding angle.
Think about this.
Test is having a match.
For months. Months now. There's going back to SummerSlam. Test had to go through a whole ordeal to win the heart of Stephanie McMahon, then fight off her family, then gain the trust of her family, only for all of it to be ruined by this nefarious Triple H.
Yeah.
And this is his chance to get revenge on the man.
I mean, have Test and Stephanie talked since this happened?
Not that I've seen.
I mean,
they've had no. They were not together on this Raw.
They literally have had no communication whatsoever since she ended up married to another man.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, this is ridiculous.
So the story of this match is actually about Kane going after X-Pac. Nobody cared about Test and Hunter. He just tags in and starts wrestling with him like it's any other tag team match. There was a point where X-Pac chopped him and he called him a bastard. Always great. So X-Pac chases Tori into the ring. Tries to give her a Bronco Buster, but Kane makes a save. That was a great spot. While this is going on, Hunter hits Test in the testes, in fact, and hits a pedigree, and then he pins him, and that's the end of Test. Jesus!
So much for that guy's career.
He didn't even get a Raw main event.
Nothing. He didn't get jack shit.
He got pinned in a tag match in the middle of Raw, and as far as I know, he and Steph don't ever talk to each other again.
Fuck. I wouldn't talk to this guy again if I were her. What a goddamn loser.
He's a geek.
Fuck, my husband-to-be... I get drugged and married at a chapel in Vegas, and this fucking guy just disappears. He doesn't talk to me. He didn't try and beat up my new husband.
Oh, he tried.
Dude, no, he didn't. Like they started with it. It was a tag match. He like tagged in, yeah, and locked up and he did moves.
He tagged in. He started on the apron.
Yep.
Kane, big fella, you go and give this a go.
Yeah, you take. I'll take care of this guy in a little while.
You warm them up. You wear them down. I'll take them off when they're good and weak. This is.
It's fucking ridiculous.
Unbelievable.
No more push, that's for sure.
No. Al has a message for his mystery partner backstage.
Get ready.
I've actually already forgotten who it was. Big Show. I watched this on like Friday. Oh, yeah, that's right. I remember now. Big Show versus Viscera happened in the ring.
Oh, my God.
It was better as a backstage brawl.
No. I could watch this 100 times. It was fucking terrible.
It sure
but
was.
They decided they were going to have a 5-star match. They failed in every conceivable way.
They tried.
But they tried. They were like...
5-star effort.
Viscera hits him with his big-ass fucking Samoan drop. Viscera decides he's going to do a bulldog.
Yes.
Which, by the way, they fucked up.
Of course they did.
He lost his head in the middle of the move and then like fell on his head. Like how that was in the pin, I got no idea. Show goes up top for the fucking worst drop kick. This guy used to do drop kicks off the top when he was like skinny.
Yes.
Sure.
Now he's 3 times that size. And he decided, I'm going to jump off the fucking top with a dropkick. Goddamn near killed himself. What the fuck were they thinking?
He ended up doing a leg drop on the mat.
Yeah.
It was talking about Big Viz and... never mind. Go ahead.
So, did the match end or we go right to the promo? Because Boss Man shows up on screen...
Show hit the dropkick and pinned him.
Oh, he pinned him with a dropkick. Mm-hmm. He pinned him with that horrible dropkick?
Yeah, that was a finish.
Oh my God. No one called an audible and said, do anything else?
Dude... A 500 fucking pound man leaped off the top rope and kicked you in the fucking head. And you're going to kick out?
I don't think he did, though.
It looks like a meteor.
He threw out a 500 pound man.
Nah, he hit him.
Well, regardless. Boss Man.
That's your problem with this show?
Yeah, it doesn't matter what the finish was after the thing that followed that.
That's fair.
It didn't matter.
That's fair, because the Big Boss Man shows up on screen. He has gone to the Big Show's mama's house in South Carolina, wherever she lives. She's crying. She's sobbing. Having a very bad day. Boss Man says, I've been doing a little investigating. I order you to tell the Big Show what's in this packet or I'll do it. And Mrs. Show, through her tears, confesses that she was not married when she gave birth to the Big Show.
He's illegitimate.
He's illegitimate, she says through tears. Boss Man says, well, that makes him a bastard.
He says, so what you're saying is your son's a bastard?
A bastard.
She says, yes, it was a long time ago. She's in hysterics, but it's like, it's hilarious.
Yeah.
It's not
like,
good.
It's like she's laughing.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know.
So Boss Man
turns... The thing is, like, if horrible, tragic news is given to you, like, I can understand being in hysterics. Okay, this is news she's known for 50 years or so.
How old do you think the Big Show is?
Well, 30 years, whatever. I mean, for a long, 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 long fucking time.
Yeah, but now her little boy's going to find out.
Well, she didn't know that. She didn't know she was being filmed. Of course, there's a fucking camera.
That's true.
With
he did say
a big ass red light on it.
When it was done, he pointed out there was a camera there, and then she freaked out more.
Yeah.
But he looked right into the camera and says, "You're a bastard. That's 10 times worse than your dad being dead."
God.
I don't think so. I can't speak of personal experience, but I bet it's not.
Well, it's not his dad.
Then here I wrote here, there is no way I can properly express how terrible this
was. I guess
was.
It is his dad. It is his dad.
Well, no.
But the guy that died...
They never said, the guy you thought was your dad is not your father.
No, that's what the angle is supposed to be, though.
Well, they did a horrible job explaining that, because I didn't get that until you told me just now.
Well, that's what it is. Yeah.
Are you sure?
I'm positive.
It's not his biological father.
I'm positive.
That passed away.
Yeah. Well, the yes, exactly. The man that raised him that died.
This is news to me.
Is not the Big Show's real father.
So
conceivably there's another father.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mr. Or Andre White. Is really his father.
Mm.
We don't know.
Yeah.
I don't even fucking remember if another dad shows up. He may still be out there for all I know.
I totally misinterpreted this.
What'd you think it was about?
That she never said. Your dad's not who. Your father was not your father. She said you're illegitimate, which just means born out of wedlock. That's what I thought she was so upset about.
Oh, I gotcha.
I see. Yeah. Well, it's not true. Yes, Rob.
You know what this means, Craig?
No, tell me.
It means Pearl Jam song Alive. It's about Big Show.
I never thought of that.
You never thought of that?
No.
Wow.
Actually, it's about Eddie, but that's another story.
Craig, we're not here for facts.
I'm sorry.
I thought the song was about being alive. I didn't know there's more to it.
Listen
than that.
To the lyrics. It's not.
It's Eddie Vedder. I can't understand them.
I'll write them out for you.
All right.
We can't read your handwriting.
So, Big Show is on the phone, distraught, wants to know why his mother never told him about his father. And here I wrote, the dumbness. It's overwhelming.
Why didn't you tell me I was a bastard for all those years? Why did you have to pretend that it was my real father and bring me up in a nice house?
This is horrendous.
I would have preferred you told me I was a bastard, a rotten bastard. Why didn't you tell me this?
But it's so easy to laugh at how awful
it is. It's ridiculous. It's fucking ridiculous.
By the way,
surfed on his dead illegitimate father's casket on fucking Thursday.
He's the world champion.
This is... Oh, I forgot.
Going into a pay... He has a title defense on Sunday. This is their build for it. That's poor. That's poor build. Rock and Sock Connection versus Al Snow and a mystery partner.
I figured out that fucking storyline before I figured that he's defending the title against the Big Show on Sunday.
Yeah.
Jesus fuck.
Well, the mystery partner is Chris Jericho.
Yes, he was.
So
fuck, dude. I can't get over this Big Show thing. Jesus. It's terrible.
So Jericho
ate his dog.
That's Boss Man. That's Boss Man and Al Snow.
Al Snow, yeah. It's another horrible thing.
But it's been a hell of a year for the Big Boss Man.
Boss Man was like the heel of the decade.
Yes.
He never got enough awards.
For best heel?
Yeah, for most diabolical fucker. Should be a category in the Observer Awards.
MDF?
Yeah.
So Jericho's cutting this promo, running down Rock and Foley until China jumps in from behind and the match is going on. So I'm watching this, and it occurs to me that to this point, this is probably the biggest match in the careers of Al Snow and Chris Jericho. They are main eventing Raw against two of the three biggest active stars in the roster right now. This crazy heat for it. Everyone's going nuts. This came off like a major, major league deal. And for Snow and Jericho at this point, that was not an every week occurrence.
I would say for sure Al Snow.
Yeah.
I don't know about Jericho. He had some big damn matches when Nitro was winning. They were doing huge numbers. He was a big time star.
Yeah, but not in this company.
No, but, I mean, in wrestling.
He was never a main eventer on Nitro.
He was a big name. I don't consider him a main event until he's working a singles match.
Fair enough.
Al Snow is not a fucking main eventer. He's also in this match, in the main event.
No. For one day, he was.
Yes.
Oh, let's see. Al and Jericho have a bright idea to do a double missile dropkick off the same turnbuckle. Didn't go well.
No.
There's a four-way. Mick gets a Socko Claw. The Rock hits a Rock Bottom on the ramp. Ow. Why would you do that? And then the Outlaws jump the jump Rock. They jump Mankind. I guess it's a DQ. We never really got a bell or an announcement. And the Outlaws are actually get beat up as Rock can fully turn the tables, but Al gives Mankind head, and the show ends. That's what happened.
Well, he did. I do have to say that Al Snow has turned on Mick Foley. Mm-hmm. He threw his book in the garbage can.
Now, no, yes.
He attacked him. Mm-hmm. He fought him in this match. And then at the end, he took a fucking head and he waffled Mick in the head with it. Maybe giving Mick his first concussion in a while.
That's right.
So his streak is over. And then as the show goes off the air, Al Snow screams, "I'm your real friend." I loved that.
He's a crazy bad guy.
He is a crazy fucking bad guy.
Yes.
He thinks that he's a guy's real friend.
Yes.
All right, you ready for your gimmick?
I am prepared.
All right. Well, let's find it here.
The finishes on this show were DQ due to run-in, though I don't know who got DQ'd. Pin after weapon shot. Double DQ due to run-in. Clean pin, clean pin. Pin after low blow. Clean pin. And then no finish in the main event.
Excellent.
Retro Raw number 342, December 13th, 1999. So at Armageddon the night before, Stephanie turned on her father, Vince McMahon. She and Hunter are really married now.
Yeah.
This happened much, much faster than I remembered it happening.
You know what's so funny about Hunter and Steph together, though, is at this point, they aren't together.
Right.
But now we see them all the time, and they are married in real life.
Yes.
Okay, so it's very, very different watching them today and watching them in 1999 when they weren't together. Mm-hmm. They have to kiss each other. They have to, like, you know, sit next to each other and pretend like they're married.
Yeah.
But they're so incredibly awkward with each other right now.
There's zero chemistry.
It's awesome.
There's zero chemistry, but how to put it? They both want it to work, but it's not working. Does that make sense?
No.
Okay.
What are you trying to say?
It's like an eighth grade relationship.
Kinda. Yeah. It's like, well, gotta kiss her now.
Mm-hmm. Peek into Vinny's life.
I was gonna say, what are you talking about?
That didn't happen in eighth grade, I'll tell you that much. So Jericho comes out. He's the Intercontinental Champion now. He's cutting a promo. This is his show. X-Pac interrupts, says he's sick of people buying Jericho's crap. Challenges into a match. Jericho accepts. China comes out to watch.
Who the fuck is the babyface here?
There's one.
Like,
Jericho, China. The answer's China.
Jericho comes out, and he's cutting, like, a heel promo.
Yes.
And then X-Pac comes out, and everyone chants asshole.
Yes.
And I'm like, are they chanting at him or Jericho?
Him.
And then later, he's with DX, so he's clearly a heel.
Yes.
And I think maybe Jericho's supposed to be a babyface.
No.
Mm-mm. Okay, well, I don't know.
He just beat China the night before.
He came out here and bragged about and was very arrogant about his win. Mm-hmm. So they have a fun match. It goes a million miles an hour. And then China takes the ref and just hits him for the DQ. The announcers then had this conversation. I don't understand this. That didn't make sense. It certainly doesn't.
I can only presume the storyline is that China doesn't want anyone else to beat Jericho for the Intercontinental title. It must be her.
I guess.
That's the only thing that makes any sense. Because she hits the ring and punches the ref for the DQ. Like, what? Announcers didn't know what was going on. Nobody knew what was going on.
Shane confronts Hunter and Steph, and Shane McMahon is appalled Steph would turn on her dad. You only have one family, he says.
He says, when you grow up, you're going to find out what you did to this family.
Did I dream the last year?
Well, I mean, the reality is she is grown up.
That too.
And I don't think she regrets what she did to her family. And then Hunter wants a hug, says we're brothers now. Shane wants no part of this. When you look at where Hunter is now and where Shane is now, just a mind-boggling to watch this.
About to spend Christmas together, I'm
in
sure.
Action. No, like one of them's running the company and one's not. And the one who's not is the McMahon. This was the beginning of the end for Shane, too.
Yeah.
He didn't even know it.
No, none of us knew it.
Maybe, well, I knew it.
Did you?
Yeah, go back to the Observer Live. It's on YouTube.
All right.
Yeah. I didn't know I knew it at the time. But I knew it.
Okay.
I said Hunter's the smartest man in wrestling. Mm-hmm. He's fake marrying Stephanie. They're going to really get married.
I see.
And he's going to run the company.
Okay.
That's what happened.
The Godfather comes out. He's doing his intro. He's interrupted by GTV, which shows Mark Henry in the Afterglow with Mae Young.
Guess it ain't going to be Goldust now. He's on the other show.
Yeah. I don't think we ever did find out who it was, did we?
No. Yeah. I think they did one angle where they revealed it was like the Hornswoggle reveal. It was something dumb. Anyway,
May says, why is it all you men want to talk? Next thing you know, you want to cuddle. So we get Godfather versus Mark Henry. Mark Henry, in case you've forgotten, is really fucking strong.
Yeah.
He's throwing Godfather around in here. May hits the ring. The Godfather's distracted. Henry pins him with a roll-up.
Whoop-dee-doo.
A limousine arrives. Shane is there to meet it. It's Vince with a sledgehammer. Shane tries to calm him down. Vince hammers down DX's door, but they're not in the ring. Vince says, I'm going to the ring. Or they're not in the locker room. Vince is going to the ring. Shane says, well, I won't go with you. Why not?
I have no idea. Maybe he thinks his dad will kill everybody.
I guess. So Vince goes out to the ring. Call center, E. Coward, and I'm quoting Vince McMahon here.
Mm-hmm. Let's do the entire quote.
All right.
Come on out, you coward. Come on out, you rapist.
That's what he said.
That's what he said. I cried.
Maybe he meant to say therapist.
He definitely didn't. He called him a rapist.
Okay.
Didn't even follow his own storylines. It wasn't rape. It was planned the whole time.
Yeah. That we know.
They don't do rape.
In hindsight, yes. It's very clear.
What have you done to my family? What have you done to my daughter? Who, by the way, she's now got leather pants on.
Mm-hmm. And crimped hair.
Still an atrocious... I don't even know what she's wearing as a top. It's like some weird...
It's a shirt.
It's just weird. And she's crimped her hair. She's got makeup on.
Yes.
And...
She's hotter. We can all sit.
She's all made up like the modern day heel Stephanie.
Yes.
Except her voice is 5 octaves lower today.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know why.
I don't either.
It's weird.
Yeah. I got some theories.
So... Vince is still... He wanted Hunter to come out so he could kill him with a sledgehammer. Steph comes out. He's very bewildered, but he's still breathing hard and carrying a sledgehammer. And Steph dares him to hit her and actually says, this is a quote she said on the show, raise that hammer high above your head and bash in my brains. He didn't.
No.
She said she loved Andrew but wasn't ready to get married. That's what Vince wanted. All I could think was, she's awful here, but so much better than she is today.
Well, I mean, as a performer, she's much better today.
Mm?
But I've seen her for 19 years, and I'm fucking sick of her.
I don't watch Raw, but I do watch pay-per-views.
Well, you need to watch more.
And every time she's on pay-per-view, I want
to
punch you.
Well, what does that have to do with... What does that have to do with me?
You made me watch pay-per-views.
Fuck off, Vinny. Get out of here. Got to do something.
She reminds Vince, and she makes a good point... He had her abducted and locked in a rat-infested basement with no light. And as she's making this...
Now, if there'd been light, you know, that'd be okay.
Making this legitimate complaint as the crowd calls her a slut. She says Vince went through her things, had her strapped to a symbol to be sacrificed to the Undertaker in a wedding. So she outright says she married Hunter just to get back at him.
Yeah.
Hunter, by the way, cool with all this.
Hey, but now they're in love, she says. I used to get butterflies when he would look at me. Didn't want or mean to, but all of this had to happen, and now...
Now she says, Triple H really turns her on.
Yeah. When she said, I'm not daddy's little girl anymore, I'm doing things my way, and it feels damn good, all I could think was, I hope I die young.
Yep.
Rob, yep. Everyone here nodding their head. This fucking life thing sucks sometimes.
Oh, yeah.
So, Hunter comes out, he says... Since you missed this, Dad. Have you ever noticed? It goes back to the lack of chemistry they have. Every time Hunter has to say he's going to seal it with a kiss or seal the deal or whatever, he stumbles over and takes him like 5 tries.
Yeah.
And then he has the most awkward kiss with Steph on stage.
They're falling in love before our eyes.
I guess.
It's awesome.
So.
And fucking creepy.
So Vince and
Stephanie
Shane,
there telling her real life father that this guy turns her on.
Yeah.
Like, Jesus, it's fucking family. I don't know.
Rob, do you have any kids?
Two.
I don't have any kids. I'm the only one. It's all a mystery to me, guys. I don't know what you're going through. So Vince and Shane have had enough. They just leave. Let's get in the car and go home. Lucky bastards. Hunter and Steph wave goodbye and say, well, I guess we're in charge. Makes sense to me.
I was fine with the show up until this point. Let me take over here for a sec.
All right.
The fucking Rock comes out, and he cuts a promo on Wade Boggs.
Mm-hmm.
This was fun. Wade Boggs having the time of his life. Dudley's come out to cut a promo. Rock shuts him down. So this leads to... What the fuck was this? The Rock and Sock Connection versus the Dudleys.
Yeah.
Okay, you weren't paying attention, clearly, Vinny, because you're looking at me like I'm crazy.
Yeah.
They're having a match. Bubba grabs a chair.
Yes.
The ref takes a chair away from him. Rock grabs Bubba. He gives him a clothesline. The fucking ref then calls for a DQ. For a fucking clothesline?
He was slow on the draw.
What in the fuck was this?
The DQ was for the chair.
Hunter comes out and says, this match is no DQ. The match restarts. These motherfuckers go to the corners and they're waiting for fucking tags.
That did happen.
In a no DQ match?
That did happen. There were a lot of chairs in this.
Jesus Christ.
They hit each other the chairs. Oh, well, they hit the Dudleys with the chairs over and over again.
So they're doing a bunch of chair shots and it breaks down to a tag match. Foley's selling. Rock won't get in the ring, even though it's no DQ. He's waiting for a legal tag, as are the heel Dudleys. And then finally, Rock gets a tag. D-Von pulls Bubba out of the ring. And Hunter and Steph come back out. It's a fucking Baron Corbin show. This is when I realized what I was watching. And they send down a fake Vince. He goes down to the ring.
Ref in a Vince mask.
He puts D-Von on top of Foley for the pin. I don't even know how Foley got knocked out. He's just laying on his fucking ass. So he counts the pin. They ring the bell. The match is over. Then Foley pops up. Rock throws the fake Vince in the ring. Foley unmasks him. It's Al Snow. Then Rock hits a rock bottom on Bubba. The ref, the original ref, comes out. He counts the pin. We have the second finish of a match that got restarted. But I hated this more than anything on Nitro.
Really?
There was nothing on Nitro more bullshit than this segment right here.
Wow. I thought this was a lot of fun.
Same here.
I'm not here for fun. I'm here for fucking logic.
Rock had a great promo.
That's the only good thing about this.
I thought the wrestling in this match was fantastic. The Dudleys looked great. Bubba looked awesome in this match.
Bleeding all over the place.
He get hit.
Well, I can't take any more of this.
Hit in the head with a chair, bleeding everywhere. It just kept on going. There was a lot of bullshit at the end. But at least it wasn't like a 2-minute match and then bullshit.
Oh, it was a long match and then bullshit? That's better?
Well, I thought so.
I disagree.
I thought they had a really, really good match with a stupid bullshit finish.
Well, if you would have watched fucking Raw, you would have thought the same thing that I did.
Well,
bunch of stupid bullshit. Heel, GMs, ruining all this shit, restarting matches, fucking two finishes. Literally, I'm done.
Hunter and Steph and X-Pac are backstage laughing at pudding for some reason. I heard maybe 20% of this. Then there's just a giant pool of pudding there. Thank God Hunter and Steph knew they would be in charge and went to the trouble of arranging however many gallons of pudding there are.
Hey, well, at least we found out that the Emmergen show was a show where Miss Kitty's boobs came out.
Mm.
And she's now the women's champion. She demands to be called the Cat.
Yeah. You're missing the Mean Street Posse getting beat up by the Acolytes.
No, they were signed to meet the Acolytes.
Signed to meet the Acolytes, thank you. Yes. Yeah. So then Miss Kitty comes
out. Sorry I missed that important detail.
Well, it's our job to review the show.
It is. We'll get to the match later.
So Miss Kitty comes out. She's the women's champion now, and she is just basically naked. A very, very, very small, brightly colored swimsuit. And I'm looking at her, thinking, okay, there's a naked woman on TV. How is putting her in pudding going to make it hotter?
Well, because, Vinny, you can see that she's wearing a bikini.
Mm-hmm.
But if you cover her in mud, you can no longer see the bikini. So she looks more naked.
I see.
That's the theory, I guess.
I was fine with the bikini.
Who the fuck knows?
So, yes, Kitty insists that she now be called the Cat. No longer Miss Kitty.
They brawl in the mud. X-Pac comes out the other in one scuba gear.
Tori, by the way, is her opponent.
Yes.
Who is forced by the bullying, oppressive regime to wrestle in her bra and panties.
Because she didn't bring her gear.
Didn't bring her gear. So she comes out and humiliated strips as the crowd cheers. This is just lovely. Pleasant television.
This is all post-Russo.
Yeah.
X-Pac falls into the fucking mud.
In his scuba gear.
He falls on Tori. Cat wins. Kane comes out, chokeslams X-Pac in the mud. He's slipping around on this fucking mud. He almost kills himself. The Outlaws come out and attack Kane. Fuck, I wrote, this show is awful. And then Kitty tosses Lillian into the mud because Lillian called her Kitty instead of Cat.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You like this show?
I like the other match. I'm not defending this. You missed the part where Tori jumped on X-Pac's back, and he basically went to snapmare her into the pool and just slammed her right on her head. I really hope that was well padded, because that looked very violent.
There's no way it could be.
So this was, in fact, sex and violence. That's what this was. Lawler tries to plug a Steve Austin doll that cuts his catchphrases, and it won't work.
This was incredible. The doll, there's no batteries in the doll. They don't know that. So they put the fucking mic up to the doll, and no sound comes out. And so they're like, oh man, that sounds awesome. They pretend that they heard something, okay? Later, they have to do it again because they find batteries. So they put batteries in, and the second time around, the doll actually talks.
Yeah.
They heard voices.
One of them here said it worked in rehearsal.
Fuck.
So I don't know. Acolytes versus the Mean Street Posse. They beat him up for a bit, and then JBL ended the life of Peter Gass. It may have ended the chair as well when he wrapped this chair around Pete's head.
He didn't hit him with the seat of the chair. He hit him with the edge of the seat of the chair, and it folded it in.
It folded like origami.
Oh, my gosh.
Folded like aluminum foil.
This poor man.
Ross said, hey, it's a neurologist's nightmare.
That's what he said.
Why?
They didn't know.
Oh, there's brain injuries?
There's brains in that
head. How about that? I didn't know they knew that in 1999. Yeah. This fucking sucked.
Yeah. And then they didn't even bother to pin anybody. This got a no finish. Lawler tried again with a toy. Ross gave up. The Outlaws joined Hunter. He shared his ham with him. That's what happened. Hardy versus Edge and Christian in a random cage match.
God damn it. They're in there just doing spots just for
just
the fucking
trying
hell of
to
it.
Kill themselves.
They're literally 2 minutes in, and Jeff does a senton off the cage and crashes and burns.
Yeah.
Edge goes up top, and he's supposed to do a corkscrew dive
by
off the top, but he doesn't want to actually do a dive off the top, so he kind of starts to fall and then turns in midair for his dive. So he falls from as low as possible, but still doing the move.
The only way to win this was to have one man escape the cage. So when Jeff climbs the top and the other guys are all down, and instead of climbing down to win, he jumps into the cage and misses a move. He is a complete moron in and out of storyline.
Yeah, he's an idiot.
He's a complete fool. So Matt and Christian are brawling in the cage. They fall on the floor. It's a tie. So
well, they're going down, and then Jeff and Edge do a powerbomb into the cage, which knocks them both to the ground.
Yep.
So you got a fuck finish here, and the ref rules, well, the match must continue. So Lawler and Ross say, well, what does that mean? Do they have to get back in the cage? Well, no one fucking knows. The ref doesn't even say what to do. So Jeff and Christian end up in the ring, and this is a match that's like, can you just do a fucking cage match? They had to do every... It was complete overthinking. We've got to do a bunch of wacky dives. We've got to do a fuck finish first. Then we've got to do a restart. Then one guy goes over the top, but another guy puts him in chicken fight position
blocks
so he can't
him.
Get his feet to the ground. Mm-hmm. Then the other guy is going to get thrown into the cell or jump into the cage or whatever and fall outside and win.
Yeah, Edge wins by, even to win this match, he basically has a tope through the cage door with no one to catch him and splats on the floor.
Yeah.
These guys beat the hell out of themselves for no reason here.
They're killing each other for no reason. They could have just had a match, which would have been better.
Yes. Kane is leading Tori away. Tori is dressed only in a towel outside in December. But Hunter says, Kane, you can't leave. You got a triple threat match next. And Kane is frustrated, but hey, it's business. What are you going to do?
She couldn't take off her bra and panties and put her clothes back on?
I don't know.
I hate this show. I hate wrestling. On Monday and Tuesday, I hate wrestling. By Thursday, I start to feel better again. Usually by the weekend, I love wrestling again. And then Monday and Tuesday come, and I'm like, I fucking hate this. I'm so dumb for watching this every day of my life. Just a bunch of stupid shit. It makes no sense. It's stupid. They think we're stupid. It's a fucking woman leaving with no clothes, even though she showed up in fucking clothes. She didn't go into the mud with all her clothes on. Right?
Right.
She took her fucking clothes off.
They made a point of
this. So put the fucking clothes back on before you go outside. Why is this shit so stupid?
I don't know.
Dude.
The triple threat is Road Dogg versus Billy Gunn versus Kane. Mr. Ass.
Straight out of Raw.
It is
one,
Raw.
One good guy versus two bad guys.
Yes.
Bad guys beat up the good guy. Of course, the good guy loses. That's it.
That's really it. I just want to mention Mr. Ass kissing his sons on national television.
Mm-hmm.
Ass Jr. and I presume Ass the Third. At this point,
Oh, Jesus.
Stephanie Christ. And Hunter are backstage. They're watching TV. They're enjoying the show. And Stephanie, like, a light bulb goes off and she says, "Hey, what about the WWF Championship?" A fine question. An hour and 45 minutes into this show, the night after a title defense, which you've mentioned nothing about.
Well, that's because the championship match went 3 minutes. In a match where, in 2 minutes, everyone was chanting, "Boring."
They remember, that's right, Big Show hasn't been on yet, completely burying him. They put him in a handicap match because, as Hunter says, most of Big Show's matches resemble handicap matches anyway.
So it went 1 minute and 58 seconds, and it felt like 30 minutes. Is this the longest 158 in history? I think it was.
I don't know. They finally got Austin's toy to cut a promo. Big Show versus Big Boss Man and Prince Albert, where if the heels win, the Big Boss Man is the world champion.
What?
Yeah.
I didn't even get that.
Yep.
That's news to you? Yeah, the title is on the line here. Lillian said so anyway. I assume she was right. Taz's tattoo is on the screen. So they're doing this match. They cut backstage to show DX paying very close attention. All I could think watching this was, remember how cool the Giant was in WCW? And then he comes here and he's got to learn how to work, and now he just fucking sucks?
He sucks, dude.
Why is he throwing drop kicks?
I don't know.
They're horrible. Show sells a kick that misses by a mile. Everyone boos. There's a choke slam on Albert. Boss Man, I think, I watched this like 3 times, I'm pretty sure Boss Man busted himself open throwing a headbutt. And then Show just out of nowhere chokeslams him and pins him and just looks exhausted.
Yeah, so they beat the Boss Man, so that's it for that guy.
Yeah. We cut back to the DX locker room where Steph says, "Hey, I want a tag team title match."
Oh, fuck, here we go. Steph says, "I want to see a tag title match." The Outlaws say, "We don't want to work again." Steph says, "You're working." Hunter says, "My wife says you're working, you're working." So the Outlaws are all pissed off. "Well, who are we going to wrestle?" Steph says, "Well, I haven't seen Hunter wrestle either." Ellis is like, "Aha, smartass!" Hunter says, "Well, who's my partner going to be?" She says, "Test." So it's the Outlaws versus Triple H and Test.
Yes.
The fucking announcers have to act like, "Oh my God, I can't believe it. Hunter and Test are going to team up together and they're going to face the New Age Outlaws."
Yes. The three dumbest people in the world.
Jesus Christ.
Jim Ross and Jerry Lawler, and in first place by a mile is Test.
So this fucking moron Test comes out, teams with Hunter. Hunter, by the way, he was doing a rehearsal for the pay-per-view with Vince. And he blew out his knee.
Oh. Ooh.
That's why he didn't work. That's why he had his leg all taped up. So if you ever saw that match with Hunter and Vince, it went a half hour,
awesome.
A Triple H classic.
Yikes.
Half hour with a bum leg.
And an old man.
And a 54-year-old guy who couldn't work. So anyway.
This sounds like a shitty pay-per-view.
And this idiot Test, the best match on the show, according to Dave, was Jericho and China, which I believe he gave 2.25 stars to, maybe 2.75. That's a bad fucking pay-per-view. So Test is out there getting beat up by the Outlaws. Hunter standing on the apron. Pretending like he's waiting for the tag.
He's burying Test for getting beaten, which was funny.
You know what's going to happen. Everybody knows what's going to happen. The only two people on the planet who don't know what's going to happen are Jim Ross and Jerry Lawler. Mm-hmm. And fucking finally Hunter gets in and they all beat up on Test, making him look like an absolute fucking idiot. The announcers are stunned. They cannot believe it's a setup. Like, I can't do this anymore. I cannot watch wrestling anymore.
It's hard, at least
WWE.
It's hard to watch shows that assume you are as dumb as a rock.
Yeah.
A rock, not the rock.
No, yeah, thank you. Key clarification. One of them finally said, "Stephanie McMahon set this up and Test walked right into it." He sure did, that dipshit.
By the way, why is Stephanie mad at Test? What did he do?
He was a pawn she used to get back at his dad, or her dad.
Right.
Maybe his too. And now that she's done, she hates him.
Why?
She's mean.
He didn't do anything.
She's mean.
She's a heel, Craig.
Understood.
She's got to wipe this from her memory so that all of her love for him flitters into the...
Flitters?
Ether.
Flitters.
You heard me.
Into the ether. Flitters into the ether.
Yeah.
Wow. That's
yeah,
poetic.
She's got it. She got to end this.
Kind of.
So they hit Test with a chair. X-Pac comes out. They all pose over him. Steph's having the time of her life. She's way better as a heel. And there is no finish here.
Nope.
But that's fine.
It is?
I don't know.
The show blew in every conceivable way. Are you ready for your music?
Always.
I don't even know what it is anymore.
Who cares?
Wow.
To sing.
Tough room.
The finishes on this show were DQ due to attack on ref by a third party, pin after distraction, fast count by a crooked ref but then overruled by a fair count by a real ref, pin after distraction in a pudding match, no finish in a handicap massacre, win via escape in the dumbest cage match of all time. Oh, that's not true. The Dr. Death cage match was much dumber. Mm-hmm. Clean pin in a triple threat match, no finish in the main event.
Sweet.
All right.
What a great show that was. Okay.
All right. WWF Retro Raw number 343, December 20th, 1999.
Dude, are you all lucky that Baron Corbin's no longer GM?
So you're going to keep doing this show?
I'll say.
Yep. I'm here, everyone. I'm still doing it. It wasn't that bad.
By the way, this table's gross.
Craig, I mean this in the nice way possible, but fuck off. The table? There was human excrement all over where you're sitting right now.
I think there's some on the table.
No, it's just liquor. I was right here watching him vomit. It got all over the floor right there.
See that, Vinny?
That is not vomit.
See that?
Yes, Rob. Now I'm already pissed off. Go ahead, Rob. Where are we?
I'm glad I could piss you off more. No, to be fair, Craig, I was actually here when it all happened, and the puke did not get anywhere near.
Nowhere near the top
maybe
of
on the
desk.
Floor. Maybe under your feet, perhaps, mm-hmm. but not on the desk.
Okay.
God, $125 I paid literally to clean out right under where you're sitting. There was nothing where I'm sitting, nothing where Vinny's sitting. $125 I paid to clean that right there where you're at. First thing he says is there's vomit all over the fucking table. There's
Isn't
no
this
vomit
your carpet
on the table.
Where I'm sitting?
Yeah, but I'm not the one
so
that has to sit
there. So take some pride in your carpet. Shut up.
I'm not the one that has to sit there.
Jeez.
And I'm buying a damn new couch tomorrow on top of all of this. Oof. Trying not to lose my temper, and then I have to hear there's vomit on the fucking table, or the table sticky.
It's...
Shall I have my wife bring up something we could wash off the table? Go ahead, Vinny. Where are we?
The very beginning. We haven't said anything yet. Hunter and Stephanie are having a Christmas party. For the first time, they utter the words, McMahon-Helmsley era.
Yes.
Test versus the New Age Outlaws... Tess had no idea it was a handicap match.
Why is Tess's nose broken?
Well, they broke it on SmackDown.
Who?
They probably said I wasn't paying attention.
Okay.
So I also was not paying attention when Jerry Lawler wasn't there. Michael Hayes was on commentary. They mentioned Lawler, but didn't mention where he was.
Could he have been worse on commentary? He was as shitty as the people today.
I strongly disagree.
Just a bunch of shit that Vince feeds him.
That's true.
How many times do you have to tell us, look at Rikishi's ass? Like, I'm going to watch the show, and I'm not going to see Rikishi's ass. You know what I'm saying? Like, every spot he does involves his ass. Do I really need the commentator telling me, hey, look, his ass is in his face? I fucking see that. I'm agitated now and hot.
So the Hardys, Edge, and Christian and Terry are watching a monitor backstage, and they are, in fact, watching a monitor. The camera shows the backs of their heads, and
well,
it's pans
hey,
to show them.
Enjoy it while you can. That won't last long.
So you ever notice the test, when he throws a punch, looks like the NXT women when they lock up?
Yeah, he throws that.
Throws a leg behind him when he throws a punch. Yeah. It's odd.
Lance actually pointed that out to me, and I can't unsee it.
Yeah. So he makes his comeback, but they double team him. They take off his nose protector. They fame ass his nose, and they pin him.
What a run he's having.
The Helmsleys meet with the Hardys, Edge, and Christian.
The show is exactly like the show today. These fucking guys come in, and they say, we just keep doing the same damn matches over and over again.
We're sick of fighting each other.
We're sick of having
the
same
exact
matches.
Words.
So Hunter's like, well, I got a great idea. Well, let's do Edge and Matt versus Christian and Jeff. A new match. It's a new era. Same guys, just doing a different damn match.
They're shaking things up.
Whoop-dee-doo.
Angle meets with the McMahons, Kurt Angle. I'd forgotten this, but in the very first meeting with Hunter and Steph, he's already flirting with Steph, mm-hmm. and she's flirting back, and Hunter's not impressed.
There was a twinkle in her eye.
Oh, yeah, and a smile. And Hunter is upset, so he books Kurt against Viscera. This leaves Kurt upset and Stephanie confused about why Hunter would do this.
This is the longest build to an awful payoff there's ever been in history.
Well, yeah, Sting.
No, this is worse. That was at least a year. This goes on years.
Isn't it like next time?
It's like 2001, I think. Maybe it's 2000. But regardless, God.
So we get Matt and Edge versus Christian and Jeff. So Terry comes out with the Hardys. The Hardys came out first, and she's wearing like a shirt that's unbuttoned down to her navel.
Yes, remember this, people.
Yeah, and I'm not even sure how it stayed on her body, but I'm watching her come down, for all intents and purposes, naked. And I'm just thinking, that's a human Barbie doll. That's exactly what she looks like.
Yeah, mostly plastic.
Yeah, and with as much motion. So they do this match. It's a moves match.
Yeah, the brothers, it's allegedly two sets of brothers. Mm-hmm. It's Edge and Christian, Matt and Jeff. And when the match is signed, they don't want to do it. They don't want to wrestle each other.
Yeah.
Then the bell rings. They start beating the hell out of each other. Mm-hmm.
They were avoiding their brothers for like a minute. And then there's like a heat on Jeff, and nobody
fans are bored.
Nobody cares about this.
Nope. They tried this. This is one of those things in wrestling that infuriates me. They try to get the brothers to wrestle each other. Nobody wants to see it.
Yes.
They chant boring. And so for 20 years in like three different companies, people try to get the Hardys to feud.
Yes.
And it never works.
No.
And they just keep trying.
So the announcers were confused about who was on whose team. I think the fans were too. Finally, Edge gets back. He gets knocked off the top rope, like over the stairs. How he cleared them, I have no idea. And Christian's a kill switch, and Jeff hits a 450 splash, and he pins his brother Matt.
Yeah, lands in his own head.
Yeah.
That's why he started doing that senton.
Yeah.
It's a finish.
We have a Christmas gift for Moolah and Mae Young. It is a three-way tag team match with the Dudleys and the Acolytes. And Hunter is sure to bury JR for no good reason.
Moolah's appalled, says Stephanie is a disgrace to the McMahon family.
The Helmsleys come out, they call Ross into the ring, he outright says that he expects to be fired. So they are mad at Jim Ross because in Entertainment Weekly, he called Vince McMahon and The Rock the greatest entertainers of 1999, when he should have said it was Steph and Hunter.
What about Stone Cold?
He seems like he'd be a good candidate too.
Yeah.
So they bully him, they push him down, and then Hunter grabs him and threatens to break his arm again when Mankind comes out. I believe it was the debut of the blatantly cheap hometown pop. Mentioned the city and state you're in. Call Steph a hoe. Makes fun of Hunter for getting held back. And Hunter finally says, I'm booking you in a boiler room match. And Mankind says, I hope it's with you. And Hunter won't tell him. And then Steph slaps him. And there was no repercussions.
Of course not. No.
Anger versus Viscera. Steph is still...
This is a boring show.
Yeah, I'm going through this.
There's nothing happening here.
Steph is still upset about this match backstage. And then Steve Blackman comes out. He hits Viscera with a stick, and Angle hits the angle slam for the win. And it turns out Stephanie is the one who sent Blackman out there because she calls him Kurt Cute.
Kurt Cute.
Yeah.
Glad that didn't stick.
Yeah. That's what she called him.
Hunter is skeptical that Stephanie had nothing to do with this.
Yeah, she outright suggests that she sent out Blackman. I mean, this isn't even subtlety.
No.
It's not even like a slow build. It's like the first one they did earlier in the show, you watch it and you go, well, I know where this is going. They're just starting this now. By the end of the show, it's just like they're hammering you with it. Because you're dumb. That's what they think.
Yes.
You're so dumb that if we don't tell you exactly what's happening, like you're so stupid you won't figure it out. But then we also have to do swerves because like you're smart. You know what I'm saying?
You know where things are going.
They presume you know where you're going, so they have to swerve you.
If you know where things are going, you won't tune in.
But you're so damn stupid that they got to tell you that Stephanie thinks that Kurt is cute. I hate this company. I'm so sick of WWE.
Acolytes versus Dudleys versus Moolah and May. The Dudleys just come out, and they just start punching the old women in the face.
Yeah. Choking them.
Choking, gosh. Stomping them. So the Acolytes come out there. Mark Henry's watching backstage.
Mark Henry's watching backstage. He's in love with Mae Young.
They have a committed relationship.
Okay, so like the Dudleys are punching Mae Young in the face.
With their fists.
They're slamming Mae Young. They spread her legs and Devon does the headbutt to the vagina spot. He's just sitting back there. And finally Bubba Ray sits on her face. He's in a 69 position on the 76-year-old Mae Young. The referee counts the pin. Now Mark Henry's mad. Now he runs down to the ring. What person watches this show?
I don't know.
And enjoys it?
I don't have an answer.
I can't get over this.
Stephanie unwraps a Santa doll. Hunter reveals it's Mankind versus Santa in the Boiler Room Brawl. So we had Mankind promo about this as he's doing his promo about not wanting to fight Santa.
Yeah, but you know what? This was Foley loves Santa.
He does.
Foley is an extremely talented man.
Yeah. Also true.
Foley somehow cut a promo about how he didn't want to beat up Santa Claus, and it was compelling.
Yes.
This is one of those problems they have. They're too stupid to figure out that it worked because it was Mick Foley. So for 19 more years, we have to have stupid Christmas stuff that nobody else can pull off, except for like Mick Foley and The Rock. This may have been the most compelling segment on the entire show. Mick Foley versus multiple Santas.
Yes, Greg.
Nobody wrote this for Mankind. He did this himself because it was something he was passionate about.
Yes.
That's the other problem with the show.
So the posse jumps Mankind, throws him into the boiler room, locks the door. Mankind notes how embarrassing it is to have been beaten up by the Mean Street Posse. He finds Santa. There's an old man dressed as Santa Claus in the boiler room.
Yeah. I don't even know where to begin. So,
I guess we're supposed
who
to
who was this?
I guess we're supposed to think that was the legit Santa Claus?
In the end, I'll spoil this, everyone. It turns out this is a trap by Hunter and DX.
Yeah, but like, this was part of Hunter's trap.
But part of the trap was
to hire a real Santa?
Actually having the real Santa Claus there, apparently. They flew him in from the North Pole.
The trans from the North Pole was amazing.
Well, I mean, forget if it's a real Santa or not. Like, he found a guy to actually be Santa just to say hi to Foley in the boiler room.
It makes more sense if it's the real Santa.
None of this makes sense.
No, it doesn't actually make sense. But
he's sending in six men to beat up Mick Foley, right?
At least.
We got the Mean Street, all three. There were three random fat guys that I thought were the Mean Street Posse, but there weren't. Uh-huh. So you had three random fat guys. You had the New Age Outlaws, and you had Triple H.
And the old guy, so seven.
No, forget the old guy.
He didn't
you're getting beyond me. So you have six guys that are going to beat up Mick Foley.
Mm-hmm.
You needed a decoy? That's the story we're supposed to believe here?
Apparently.
So to get a decoy, like, he didn't just put Al Snow in the outfit. Like, he went to the mall,
sure,
hired an actual Santa, who has nothing to do with anything, and threw his ass in the boiler room? That's what happened here?
It was to lull Mick Foley into a sense of security.
He's in a boiler room about to have a fight!
I understand. I was making a joke, Brian.
I hate this show. But so, I did like... Well, go ahead.
But Foley beats up most of the Santas. The one old Santa just walks away. Beats up the three indie geeks dressed as Santa. Then fights the New Age Outlaw Santas. They put him through a table, but he still makes a comeback. He's beating them up, and he turns around, and they're in the boiler room. That's the bowels of the building. It's a dirty place. The power's run out of there. The furnace. No one ever goes in there for fun, or certainly not for decorations. He turns around. There's a picture frame with a pane of glass just sitting there.
Yeah.
What? This makes less sense than the Santas. So Foley picks up the pane of glass, and there's Santa Hunter to swing his sack into Foley's face and break the glass.
Excuse me.
That's very raw Christmas.
Yes. And he tells Mick to suck it. He leaves the boiler room.
The sack?
He is declared the winner. Christmas music plays, and that's
Let's not gloss over this. Teddy Long walks over. Holiday music is playing. Teddy Long holds up Santa's hand and says, "Here's your winner, Santa Claus." Deadpan.
That's his job.
Yeah.
Off Hunter goes. This was the best thing on the show.
It probably was. They're just saying very little.
Yeah. But
Hunter and his friends are laughing at Mick getting glass in the face. Al Snow storms in, demands a Brahma bull rope match with The Rock.
Al Snow storms in.
I didn't even think about that.
I see what you did there.
He didn't mean to.
It was a happy accident. Hunter is mad that Al interrupted him, but he wants Rock in a bull rope match, so he grants Al this match. Godfather versus Chris Jericho. Match goes 2 minutes. The hoes distract the ref, which lets China nutshot Godfather, and Jericho pins him.
Yeah.
Because as Brian said last week, only she wants to take the IC title.
Well, we don't know that.
That's what you theorized.
I do theorize that, but like, you know, it's been weeks now.
Yeah.
And no one's interviewed China.
No.
Like, these announcers are just baffled. They don't get it. They're coming up with theories. It's like, how about someone interview her and ask her what's going on here? Get Charlie out there to ask some stupid question.
What are your thoughts?
What is your motivation?
Are you mentally prepared? I want to know why the hoes, as one, got on the apron to distract the ref as their man was making his comeback.
You know what Charlie's question would be? She would say, China, is there a method to your madness?
Mm.
That I swear to God, that's the question she'd ask. Because you can't ask a dumber question. Mm. Like, of course there's a method to her madness. That's not the issue. The issue is, what's the method to your madness? But that's not what she would ask. She would say, is there a method to your madness? Then China would say something cryptic, and she would move on, and Charlie would look confused. Nothing would be answered. And there would be no follow-up question, and we'd give up for the week.
Awesome.
This is a bad wrestling promotion.
Has been for a long time. Hunter meets with BB and Terry. Says, BB, tonight you will be with Val Venus. Terry, you will be with Hardcore Holly. I am booking the first topless top rope match.
Yep.
He explains, it's a two dudes doing a battle royal. Every time a man is thrown out, the woman he represents must remove an article of clothing. And the winner, in addition to having his woman be topless, or the other guy's woman be topless, gets an IC title shot on SmackDown.
Now, since we last saw Terry in the second match on the show, she has changed into a little black dress.
She put more clothes on.
Yeah.
The point is, she's regularly topless, but she's appalled at this stipulation.
Yes.
More on that later.
So, it's Val versus Hardcore. Lillian, with a straight face, has to announce it's a topless top rope match. And Terry and BB come out on stage in their slinky little black dresses they just happen to be wearing.
Yeah.
And they're pouting and very upset about all this. Val Venus, by the way, is still the prestigious European champion. In case you'd forgotten.
I had completely forgotten, and I just watched the show.
So Hunter's out to enforce these rules. And almost immediately, both guys tumble out. Hunter says, okay, take something off, and shoes don't count. So you have to take the dresses off. And neither woman wants to, even though Terry is basically naked every single week anyway. And eventually they do, and conveniently they're happening wearing matching lace silky bra and panty sets. And of course, everyone cheers.
Hunter says, I am a god among men.
Mm-hmm. So very quickly, Holly throws Val out again. So that's it. Hardcore wins.
Well, actually, Holly, I believe, slid under the bottom rope.
No,
his feet touched the floor, but it's a top rope. To obey the rules here.
I didn't think this was worth mentioning.
It was worth mentioning.
I was trying to get through the show.
I just was like, but yes, he
won. Who cares?
I care.
So Terry leaves. Hunter now orders BB to take her bra off, reminding her several times, your job is on the line.
What job?
I thought she was an EMT.
I did too. Now she's just like a hot girl backstage. When did that trend? That's like her and Stacy Keibler. They're just like, hey, you're hot. Now you're just hired to
be
hot.
Here now.
Forget all that. Where's HR?
Yeah, this would not fly.
It's the 90s. There is no HR. HR is Triple H. He's Triple HR. Am I wrong? He runs the company.
I guess so. So eventually she's just reluctant, but it's her job, damn it. So she goes to take off her bra, and Hunter steps in front of her, blocks the view with his jacket, and then she covers up and goes backstage. Michael Hayes outright says, well, that's a ripoff. And that's the end of the segment. So.
Well, Hunter notes, do you see what I see? No, because you're all idiots.
And he also said they were magnificent.
So if you like women as human beings and want to see them treated as such, this pissed you off.
Sure.
If you don't care about women as human beings, but you want to see some boobs, this also pissed you off. This pissed off everyone.
A lose-lose.
Yes. This is the definition of lose-lose.
No, it's win-win because they're trying to get heat.
Heat, your favorite.
Yeah, they effectively got heat in this segment.
So they aired some recap from SmackDown. Somehow The Rock screwed Al Snow by switching signs on a door or some shit.
Sounds compelling.
Let's these two. Al Snow versus The Rock in a Brahma bull rope match. Yes, Craig?
Hayes said, this is Rock's specialty match.
Hmm.
Do you remember all the bull rope matches The Rock had?
It's probably the only one.
Well, he's a Brahma bull.
A Brahma bull rope match.
Here's the bigger question. Are there DQs in a bull rope match?
No.
You're swinging around a bull rope on a rope. You can choke a guy. You can hit him with a bell. Why did the referee have to take a bump in a bull rope match?
It's a fair question.
I don't know.
Ref takes a bump. Outlaws hit the ring. Rock beats him up. Road Dog waffles The Rock with a chair. Al Snow crawls over, 1-2, The Rock kicks out. So then, Mr. Ass hits the Fame Asser, this time Al pins The Rock. Why couldn't they just do the finish after the chair shot?
I don't know.
Is it not significantly less humiliating to be pinned with a chair shot than a Fame Asser? I mean, it is to me.
You got two guys are pinned by Fame Assers on the show.
If I had my option, it was like, you can either be pinned after the Fame Asser, or you can get a chair shot to the back of the head and get pinned. I'll tell you which one I'm picking. Apparently, they thought this would protect The Rock after they had Al Snow beat him.
So, two other notes here. Al Snow got cool new music. Big improvement. And but the best part of this match was they're brawling, and Al's choking him with the ropes, and the ref just shouts, 4 minutes! The posse spills Steph's flowers. Steph and Hunter are mad.
Well, the water spills all over Hunter's crotch.
Mm-hmm. And Steph's leg.
And Steph's shoes.
Yeah. So Hunter calms down and says, I'm not going to get mad. I'm going to book you against two members of Too Cool.
Well, first he says, I'm not going to freak out, but I'm going to put you in a match. And Pete Cass goes, oh man, the Acolytes. Hunter says, no, two members of Too Cool. But if you ever spill water on me again, you'll face the Acolytes every night for a year. That's a real threat.
Oh, yeah. So they go to commercial. They come back. And at first, I thought this was BB, who had quickly put her bra back on and come into the office. No, it's Tori, who's just in her underwear for some reason.
She's just there in negligee.
What's going on?
I don't have any idea. Maybe she thought she was in that other match.
We were told earlier that being forced to remove your dress and stand there in your bra and underwear on national TV is a great humiliation. Tori just does it.
Yes.
That's just how she dresses. So she's pleading for mercy or something. Hunter books Kane against The Big Show, who, in case you've forgotten, is still the world heavyweight champion.
I watch this show every week, and every time The Big Show comes out as a champion, I'm anew stunned.
It's...
What?
It is amazing in hindsight how...
horrible the Attitude Era is.
Well, that too.
Not really.
That too. But we think there have been horrible champions recently, like Rey Mysterio.
Rey Mysterio? Well, what are you talking about?
Not that recent, I suppose, but...
That's not a horrible champion, even when he was champion. Jack Swagger. How about that?
He was horribly booked as champion.
Sure.
In hindsight, there's many guys booked as bad or worse.
How about Jinder Mahal?
That qualifies too.
I mean, Big Show wins.
But he's like the third.
He's a nobody.
He's a complete nobody. At least Ray was losing in main events. So anyway, Hunter books Kane versus Show tonight and says, if the Big Show wins, Tori, you must spend the holidays with X-Pac. And she protests at first. And Hunter says, you don't think Kane can win? And she shuts her mouth and leaves.
I'm glad that you described that she protested, because I was unaware of that. I couldn't figure out what emotion she was attempting to emote.
I'm inferring.
Thank you.
Connecting some dots that may not have been clear.
As a presumption.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. The Posse versus Too Cool and Rikishi.
Okay. What a goddamn horrible match.
So the idea is, the Posse were excited when they thought it was a handicap match, but now it's a fair fight and they're screwed, right?
Mm-hmm. He did one of those spots where they're trying to whip him into a corner and he can't decide what corner he wants to run to. And so he chooses, but it's the wrong one, so they try to prevent him from going into that corner. And he's zigging and he's zagging.
The finish of this, all it is Sexay whips Ronnie into a corner. Ronnie stumbles out and gets pile-driven. That's all it is, right? They zig and zag and whip and whop and all over the place, and Ronnie doesn't know where to go. And finally, Rikishi is just standing there. He just crosses his arms. He's just waiting.
It looked like they were square dancing at
one
point.
Oh, my God. And finally, Rikishi hit this pile driver and pinned him. Hunter and Steph are backstage laughing at all this.
Kai was laughing.
They promised the title match will be loaded with mistakes.
I honest to God wish that I could have seen Hunter watching Rodney in that match. Fucking run around like a marionette. Dude. And then the main event, Big Show and Kane for the WWF title.
And if you, 10 minutes later, had forgotten Big Show was world champion again, I would not blame you.
I forgot again.
So, like a minute in, Show just grabs a chair for the DQ. Grabs a chair and hits him with it for the DQ. Mm-hmm. Why did Big Show do this?
Who cares?
Hunter says there's no DQ now.
I mean, why does he care? Like, he retained the title. He doesn't care about Tori.
Sure.
He had nothing. There's nothing on the line here.
And then they fight, and 2 minutes later, they get countered out. Now it's a double count out. And at this point, I know we cared about this, and it was all incredibly stupid, and this whole title reign is just a disaster. But goddammit, these two big mofos tried their best. The Big Show, the backdrop he took over the barricade to the floor is probably the biggest bump he took seriously in his entire career. He just went flying ass over tea kettle and smack on the pretty black mats. And he's big at this point.
JR said it looked like a 747. And honestly, in this case, he wasn't wrong. It looked like a plane going down. He was so enormous. And he flew through the air and he fucking splattered right on his side.
Yeah.
That had to suck.
And then, not to be outdone, Kane mounts the top rope and jumps from the top rope to the floor.
Kane's doing top rope dives and into Geary's. Big Show's 7 feet tall. He's got the stairs over his head. Kane drop kicks the stairs. There's a lot of cool stuff in this terrible match. And finally, Kane goes to sling Big Show over his shoulder like a British Bulldog, and he does it, which is ridiculous. But the Outlaws are there to harass Tori.
So he puts in her lingerie.
Who's still just out there in her underwear for no reason. So Big Show grabs Kane, powerbombs him through an announce desk, and pins him. And this means Kane loses. This means Tori has to spend the holidays with X-Pac. And so the Outlaws kidnap her. They take her up on stage. And DX and Steph are celebrating. Why does Steph hate all the women all of a sudden?
She hates all the baby faces.
She hates Moolah and May.
Yeah, baby faces.
She hates Terry and baby face. And Tori.
Baby face.
I guess so.
You're confused, Vinny, because there's so many baby faces on the show at this point. Unlike today, where there are none.
There are none.
Yeah. Well, would you like your music?
May as well. The finishes on the show were clean pin in a handicap match, clean pin in an incredible partners match, pin after interference, clean pin in an intergender, intergenerational three-way tag match, win in a boiler room brawl, pin after interference, pin in a bull rope match after interference from two dudes, clean pin in a trios match, and then pin in a no DQ false count anywhere match after a distraction.
Cool.
WWF Retro Raw number 344, December 27th.
Am I wrong, Lance? Am I being an asshole?
Yes to both.
Okay.
December 27th, 1999, the last show of the millennium.
God, can you imagine?
Monday Night Raw. So DX comes out for this promo, and they're... This is the you know how when you buy different all the wrestlers' toys, they gotta have a new outfit for every season, so people keep buying toys? This is their preppy gear outfit. There's turtlenecks, there's Dockers on these degenerates. So the story on SmackDown was apparently the wrestlers tried to form a union, and the McMahons put a stop to it. Amazing how that works. So Hunter says it's the last Raw of the new millennium, and he corrects himself as the final Raw before the new millennium. Then he says singest and notes this is not a word. This is not his best promo, is what I'm saying.
Not even close.
No.
I did like when he tried to save it by saying, is singest a word?
It was funny because he's being Triple H. He's being the game. And he's all serious and gravelly. And he says that, I am the singest. And he stops and he turns into Paul Levesque. Is singest a word? And he goes back into being the game. So,
but he screwed up his very first line. He actually walked to the back of the ring and leaned on the ropes. Road Dogg had to come over and like give him a pep talk to get him back on track.
It would be fascinating to get their commentary on this promo. What was going through their minds at the time? The
thing that it reminded me of the most, it's like, obviously they'd never do it to him, but it's like, R-Truth screwed up one promo.
Yeah.
And he's been booked as a dipshit for like a decade now.
Yeah.
Hunter blew this promo twice.
You're not wrong. So, Hunter orders the Big Show to defend the title tonight against him. Stephanie books Kane versus X-Pac for tonight. They run down Mankind for a while until he comes out. And Mankind notes that 1 year ago, almost to the day, it was DX carrying him around the ring as he celebrated his first world championship win.
What a whirlwind.
That was a heck of a year.
That was 1 year, and he's about to retire.
Yeah. Says he used to think they were cool. Now he thinks they are gutless cowards like kids hiding behind mom and dad. He tried to turn Hunter's lackeys against him. Called Steph a hoe. Got beat up. He rocked me the save. And
you're right over there, Lance?
I just opened your text of the photo of Giraffe.
That's what I'm doing during this show. I am a professional.
So Hunter then, he ended this promo about as badly as he started it. He took about 10 minutes to book The Rock versus Mick Foley in a pink slip on a pole match where the loser's gone for good.
Fucking Russo's gone. We still have pole matches.
I don't know.
And it's a pink slip on the pole. So, like, whoever gets the pink slip, the other guy's fired.
Yeah, they did not think this one through all the way.
It's just ridiculous.
Foley was very good here. Everything else sucked. Kane is backstage waiting patiently for Tori to arrive.
Yeah, so if you forget, last week, Tori was kidnapped, and she was brought to X-Pac to be raped, apparently.
To spend the holidays with X-Pac.
To spend the holidays against her will.
These were the stips, because Kane lost to the Big Show.
Yes, with X-Pac. And we have not seen or heard from her since, I presume. I guess she wasn't on SmackDown.
It was mentioned. We have not seen or heard from her since whole week.
So he's just calmly waiting for her to return.
China versus Crash Holly. It was short. So here's the finish. China hits a DDT. Crash kicks out. So China says, okay, hits a sleeper slam and pins him.
Yeah.
Okay.
Got Bob Holly in commentary talking about how, if that were me in there, I'd kick her ass. This guy better not lose to a girl. Crash then loses to a girl. Goes over and beats his ass. I have no idea where this goes.
Is this the first match that she's actually dominated and won that wasn't just her ball-shotting people?
It may be.
Probably, actually.
We don't watch SmackDown, so there might have been a China match or two.
Or the pay-per-views.
But, yeah.
But
on TV, yes.
Yeah.
So then she wins, and all of a sudden Kat randomly falls down. What happened there? Lawler's aghast because it's his girlfriend. He breaks character. Oh!
I watched it like 5 times, and it's hard to tell because they like step towards each other, and it cuts away. When it comes back, Cass is on the ground, and China's helping her up.
Yeah.
I think they high-fived, and China like legit knocked her over.
So powerful.
Yes.
I mean, I believe it.
So Kane is backstage when Tori arrives, and Kane gives her a big hug.
Okay, I got to say something about this segment, all right? How many times have we seen Tori act?
A bunch.
She's the worst.
Yes.
Okay? Is there anybody worse? Like, maybe the very first time Stacy Keeler was ever on television?
No, she wasn't that, no.
Okay.
I was going to say maybe like a particularly bad Linda McMahon. That would be about it.
But like, she's absolutely horrendous.
Yeah.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So they have several segments here on this program. They got more coming up. One of them, just thinking about it, I'm laughing. It's seriously the dumbest segment in the history of the Monday Night Wars, I'm pretty sure. With her
and Kane
later.
They weren't petitioning for Emmys back then.
No. But anyway, her acting in this segment was actually okay.
It was passable.
This was like, I was kind of blown away. Like, it was the most describing how she'd had a good time.
Kane's very relieved to see her alive and well. They have a big hug. And she sits him down, and there's like a bench there or something. He sits down, and she starts to explain that her weekend was fabulous.
Fabulous.
Now, correct me if I'm wrong here. Has Kane actually spoken without his voice box on here before?
I believe he had it thrown away and did a little bit, yeah.
Okay. Oh, that's right, because X-Pac was the one who said, you don't need this anymore.
Yes.
And he said, suck it. So he said 2 words as Kane in his entire career before this moment. And
can I be Kane and you be Tori?
I'll be Tori.
Okay.
Kane, it was fabulous.
What?
There's a little more surprise to it.
That was me trying to be surprised.
What? I laughed and I laughed and I laughed. It was the funniest thing Kane ever did for like 20 minutes.
Yeah, it got better.
So she explains X-Pac was a gentleman. She was always safe. She could have left whenever she wanted. But she wanted to honor Kane's commitment. But she missed him and says, let's get coffee.
There's no way she was going to tarnish his word. Despite all the gifts and presents and pampering, all she could think about was Kane. I missed you, she says. Let's go get a drink. So she goes to get a drink for him.
Yes.
I guess their drink is water. She's filling up a cup, and Tess runs into her. And he puts his arm around her, which is a little creepy, actually. Like, what's he embracing her for? She had a much more violent reaction. She flipped her lid, freaked out, stormed off, and he thought that she was crazy.
His acting might have been worse than hers.
I'm just glad Lance is here. It's appropriate because when Tori freaked out and ran away, Test, in a very Canadian manner, said, what the hell was that all about?
Yeah, they said something else that they silenced.
He may have.
Yeah.
Have they ever established that they're even friends on this show before?
No, never.
They, they've ever been on screen together before.
Yeah, he's just a random coworker that decided he was going to grab her. She didn't like it.
Imagine that.
Yeah.
And she's the heel in this scenario. He's supposed to be fine.
I guess. I guess. So, I will cut to the chase. The there's a four-corner tag match with the Mean Street Posse out doing stuff, like ring announcing and reffing and whatever. So, the four teams...
Fucking A. Are you fucking kidding me? Dude. Hold on a second, Vinny. You're not going to do this justice.
Why are you mad at me?
Not mad at you, but... First off, the Mean Street Posse's in the ring, and they don't even play all their music. Like, they begin mid-music. That irritated me. So, they announced that Pete Gass is the timekeeper, Rodney is the ring announcer, and Joey Abs is a special guest referee. Okay? This right here takes a good minute to explain all of these roles. And by the way, Rodney facially looks remarkably like Filthy Tom Lawler. You ever notice that?
I have not.
Watch next time. And Pete Gass looks like Colt Cabana. So
yeah,
anyway.
I can see that.
Then, four fucking teams come out. We have The Godfather and D'Lo Brown. They play their music. They come down to the ring. They announce The Dudleys. They play their music. They come down to the ring. They announce Edge and Christian. They play their fucking music. They come down to the ring. Then they announce The Acolytes. They play their music and come down to the ring. Like 15 minutes has elapsed. They get in the ring. They ring the bell. Posse attacks The Acolytes. Dudleys get the pin with a fast count.
That's
these not... fucking...
It's like a minute at most.
What in the fuck did we waste so much of our lives on this for? They really needed to have four fucking teams out there for a 1 minute bullshit nothing match.
I don't know.
The fucking ring entrances were like 10 times the length of the match itself. What a waste of time.
And then the Acolytes hit the Posse with a bunch of chair shots to the head.
Brutalized them.
A distraught Tori turns to the loving arms of Kane to be rescued. He's trying to calm her down. Calm down, he says. And she looks up, and with choking back tears, she says, Test violated her.
Hold on, Vinny. First she says, Test touched me. Calm down. He was looking at me, and then he stopped, and he was saying things to me. What? Kane, he violated me. Kane hugs her and then goes, Gah!
Ah!
This was I laughed so fucking hard.
This was
I laughed and I laughed. I started to cry. I rewound it. I laughed and I fucking laughed. He's a Wookiee.
Yes.
He's a fucking Wookiee.
First I thought it was a Wookiee. It was the wail of a Wookiee whose partners has passed on. And I thought more, even better, in Star Wars, when Anakin is turned into Darth Vader. And he emerges.
Oh, and Vader does that noise.
And he's told that Padme is dead.
Yes.
No!
That's exactly
what
this was.
That is what Kane did here.
This was 10 times funnier, though.
Yes. Oh, God.
Because it's Kane.
Kane emoting.
Yes.
It's always good when the rape brainwashing angles are hilarious.
Well.
Well, dude. I hate to tell you.
When they're done badly.
They're done fucking badly.
So Hunter and Steph are backstage burying the entire roster. Hunter wants Kurt Angle's winning streak to end. Wants to ensure that Steve Blackman won't interfere. Kane storms in. He demands a match with Test. And Tori says, that's right. He wants a match with Test. You can't have him wrestle X-Pac anymore.
Oh, my God.
That's their cunning plan.
It is a cunning plan.
And then she adds that Test had violated her. Hunter laughs at this. This makes Kane angry, and Hunter grants the match.
Some horrible acting.
It was some horrible acting. So Hunter wants Kurt's winning streak to end. So his solution...
Yes.
...is to put Kurt in a handicap match against the Headbangers.
That should solve this problem. This undefeated problem.
All I wrote about this...
Dude, he's been in the company for less than a month. Right?
Yeah. For just over, but yeah.
By himself, with less than a month on the main roster... He had a better match with the Headbangers than any team I can remember ever.
Probably. All I wrote about it was Blackman interferes, Angle wins with Cradle.
Yeah. I only wait about a minute, but fuck. He carried both Headbangers.
And then, you know, I see, I decided to kill both men and tap them both out, personally. But they did this, and then the Headbangers got their heat back by laying him out and botching their finish again.
Yeah, landed right in his fucking head.
Yeah. The one time
what it's supposed to look
like. Yes, the one time they got it right, it was newsworthy. But usually, this time, and it's funny, usually whichever one drops the leg is too early. This time, he was late.
So yeah, like but it was
a
weird
power bomb and then a leg drop.
Well, yeah, they went for the power bomb, but like as he lifted the guy up, the other Headbanger's already jumping.
Yes.
Like, shouldn't it be power bomb the guy so you know where he lands, then jump on him? Why do they do this, Lance? You're the wrestler here.
Because they want to make it cooler, I guess. I don't know. This is
fuck.
It's terrible.
So the best part about this is the match happens, like we see all this unfold. And they cut backstage. So by the time they cut backstage, the interference already happened like a minute earlier. And then we cut to Hunter, who's reacting to it like it's real time.
Yes.
Hey! He's
very disappointed.
Outraged this interference happened. Steph insists that she did not tell Blackman to interfere. She says, Kurt Angle is just a great wrestler, just like you. Hunter just mutters, I'd kill him.
I love this storyline. It is...
They say
it's already so good.
They say the best gimmicks are when you just turn yourself up to 10. And it's Hunter saying he'd kill everybody in the roster.
But so great because like you know where it's going. And they're not being subtle at all.
No.
You know this is leading towards a love triangle. Unfortunately, they fuck it all up at the end. But boy, it's great so far. And it only gets better.
But the important thing is they don't tell us where it's going. They're just making it clear that
yes.
We can follow along. You don't have Michael Cole pointing out 5 times that, oh,
that's
Stephanie
true.
Appears to have a thing for Kurt Angle, and Hunter doesn't look happy.
Kurt cute.
That's an excellent point. There's trouble in paradise, guys. Foley does a promo, says the pink slip on a pole match is the stupidest thing he's ever heard of.
It's up there.
Obviously not watching Nitro.
Who would be? His career is winding down, he says. Rock's best days are ahead of him. It would be a real shame for The Rock to leave the WWF, but my kids think it would be a real shame for Dad to leave the WWF. So he asked the fans to forgive him for doing whatever he had to do to win. Al Snow comes out for a promo. He's interrupted by Taz's tattoo. Al says he hates the fans, and no TV writer told him to say that.
Ugh.
Jericho interrupts. This leads to Chris Jericho versus Al Snow. So my first question was...
For the Intercontinental title.
They've specified the title is on the line.
Yeah.
And my first question was, what the hell did Al Snow do to deserve a title shot? And as I wrote that question down, they answered it by saying he lost a cage match to The Rock on SmackDown. Okay.
He pinned Rock last week.
That would be a better answer.
Yeah.
And I guess he lost The Rock on SmackDown, and that's the end of that. But he still got this title shot. So, okay. So Al Snow's a geek, right? He got a fluke win over The Rock last week, and then he got his ass kicked on SmackDown. He's back to geek level. Mm. He's never done nothing. Or something. He may have been a hardcore champion or something. He just beats the fuck out of Chris Jericho, the Intercontinental Champion, and then when he has the match won, China comes out and hits him with head for the DQ.
Yeah.
What the hell are they doing to Chris Jericho?
It's the same storyline I've been doing for 3 fucking weeks, dude.
It's worse than that with this Al Snow.
Well, yeah, but I mean, what I would like is, can somebody interview China? Like, if this is real, it's been 3 weeks. She's interfered in his match 3 fucking times on 3 straight shows. Can't somebody go up and say, China, why are you helping Chris Jericho in all of these matches? Nope. Like, I like that they're doing a storyline that's a slow build, apparently. It may be...
It's a no build.
2002 till they get to the end at this
yes.
rate. But, like, somebody should at least be asking China what's going on.
Where's Dasha when you need her?
Yeah, where is Dasha? China, why do you keep helping Chris Jericho?
China, you've been interfering in Chris Jericho's matches. What are your thoughts? Mark Henry wants Harvey Whippleman to go on a double date with May and Moolah.
Mark goes to Henry and says... Or Harvey.
Goes to Henry.
Mark goes to Harvey. He says, I've got a lot of sexual frustration built up. That's what he said.
He did. Somehow when I'm watching it, Mark says it doesn't seem so absurd.
That's what he said. He says, Harvey, will you go on a double date with me? I'm going to go out with May. You go out with Mula. Now, first off, if he has so much sexual frustration built up, like, why does he want to go on a double date? Just go out with May.
You have to mention, though, Harvey was very uncomfortable when he first said that.
Well, yeah.
He did say...
They teased that he thought he was going to take out his sexual frustration on Harvey Whippleman.
Yes. So Harvey does not want to go out with the fabulous Mula. And so Mula goozles him and talks him into it.
Yeah. That's what happened here. Mankind versus The Rock in a pink slip on a pole match. DX is enjoying the show backstage. So they're doing this match, and Al Snow runs out and attacks The Rock. This gives Mankind a chance to win.
Yeah, the guy that threw the Mick Foley's book in the garbage now wants to help Mick Foley.
Yeah.
Because he hates The Rock.
Yeah, so Mankind starts to climb, but he can't win this way. And he attacks Al, and he kicks Al's ass and sends him packing because Al's a geek. And Foley turns around like to give The Rock a hug, but The Rock just catches him and rock bottoms him. That was awesome.
What I thought was awesome was, I don't know if they meant to do this spot, because it made Foley look like an idiot. But Foley eats the rock bottom, and then later he puts the Socko Claw on. The Socko Claw.
And a pole match.
There's a sock on his hand is my point.
I see, yeah.
So then he goes to climb, and he reaches up for the fucking pink slip, but he's got a fucking sock on his hand. Did you see that? He's pawing at it with a sock on his hand.
I see.
He couldn't have got it anyway. It's like, did he mean to look that stupid, or am I the only one that noticed that? So he gets cut off, of course, and then sent outside, and Rock gets the pink slip. Rock gets the pink slip, so Mankind is fired.
Let's not gloss over this finish. Mankind is like standing on the top rope, and they're fighting up there, and Mankind takes a tumble. And he basically lands in a sitting position on the top rope, falls to his head and shoulders in the apron, and then to the floor.
Yeah.
Now, in real time, it sounds awful. In real time... Watching this in 2018, knowing Mick Foley is still alive and well, alive, I watched this and screamed my head off. It's terrifying.
Vinny, do you remember the cage match that he has with Triple H at the Royal Rumble?
It's also terrifying.
It's 10 times more terrifying than this.
Yes, so he's totally in control. He did it the way he wanted, but boy, if he had fucked this up, he'd have been bad news.
Hey, he's crazy.
He's crazy.
So this isn't the... You're retired and gone legit until they convince him to come back for Mania?
No. This, if you watch the show, like, it's pretty clear that Hunter is going to demand he comes back because he screwed Hunter in the main event. But the Royal Rumble match was always planned. It was he retired at the for the Rumble match, no, and then they talked him into coming back.
He retired after No Way Out.
No Way Out, yeah. Whichever it was.
They do Hell in a Cell, yeah.
So they don't honor the you're fired stip to make you pay for the retirement stip.
No.
No. It's, anywhere. Yeah, this is a worked retirement, and then the legitimate retirement is in 2 months, and it lasts 2 weeks. So DX is fine. They wanted both these guys gone. They got one of them. They all celebrate. Foley does a promo. Says he was planning on retiring sometime in 2000.
Can you imagine he said that?
Yes.
I can't. Like, did he not know that they were going to do retirement stip in 2000?
I think he was probably legit. When he said sometime in 2000, he may have meant February.
Well, yeah, it just was weird. Like, why give that away?
Well, I don't know that. Says it's still 1999. What just happened kind of sucks.
Kinda. My career's over.
Kinda sucks.
In a pole match.
Says, if you're bored sometime, please pull out a Mick Foley tape and watch it. Remember that I loved the last 15 years, but please don't play this match because it was a farce.
Yeah.
And then I felt bad because I watched this match.
Yeah, he gets a standing ovation. I can't imagine anyone actually thought that he was leaving here because it wasn't even the end of the show.
It came out of nowhere.
Like, Rock and Mankind in legit retirement matches in the middle of the show. It's ridiculous.
Yeah. So Foley's backstage saying goodbye to the Godfather and Edge and Christian and the Hardys. Tells them the youngsters the future of the business. Matt's got this huge shiner, which actually is even worse than that, we find out later. Our second four-corner tag match of the evening.
Oh, God. Again, this was the same thing.
It's an intergender four-corner tag match.
Oh, God.
Val Venus and the Cat versus Viscera and Jacqueline versus Prince Albert and Ivory versus Gangrel and Luna. The only good part of this was as they're all doing their entrances, Ivory and Albert come out. You've never seen someone so happy to have a specific person as their partner as Ivory was to team with Albert. She's going out of her mind having this big scary monster.
Dude, she's excited about everything.
So
I've never seen her not excited.
That's actually a fair point. She's an excitable gal.
She was excited when we were going to New York and her plane was delayed or whatever WrestleMania was last year. She's doing fucking cartwheels.
So the only woman who tagged in was Luna. She just wrestled with the guys. I'm watching Prince Albert throw punches at Luna. That's a treat. It's a total mess. I can't tell who's legal.
Who gives a shit? It was a waste of time.
Well, it ties into the finish. Because Val has Gangrel pinned, but Gangrel is not the legal vampire. So Albert pins Val with a brogue kick, and that's it. I don't know what the point of any of this was.
I don't either. Waste of time.
Giant pile of shit.
Like, the only couple here would be Gangrel and Luna.
I hope you're getting giraffe when he said a giant pile of shit. Okay. Just checking.
Mark Henry reads a love poem to May. Did anyone write it down?
Harvey tried to bury Moolah. Yeah. I did not
this
write
is
it
them
down.
Sitting at a restaurant, yes?
They're at a restaurant, yes. Mankind goes to the production truck, says goodbye to all the tech guys. I think Kevin Dunn he mentioned as well.
So next up, everybody. I've been talking about this for a few weeks now. X-Pac Heat is starting. For those of you that remember, it's been starting, and boy, was it in full effect on this fucking show. It's X-Pac versus Jeff Hardy. They had a very good match. I thought Jeff looked great doing a singles match. It wasn't long, but everything he did looked good. The people were into it. It was all action compared to everything else in this show. It was like a 25 on a scale of 1 to 10. So then Terry comes down to the ring, or she's down to the ring with Jeff Hardy.
Mm-hmm.
This idiot X-Pac starts to stalk her. He gets distracted. Jeff hits the big senton. 1, 2. X-Pac kicks out. X-Pac then gives him a low blow and an X-Factor for the pin. Now listen, it doesn't really matter. Jeff Hardy's a tag guy. But fuck, you can't have Jeff Hardy beat X-Pac. It wouldn't have hurt X-Pac one iota. And these guys having a really good match and putting Jeff Hardy over with that senton. Fuck, there was even interference here to set it up. But no, X-Pac had to get his big win here and beat Jeff Hardy. I still loved this, but this was like, this happens every single show for like a year, it feels like. He's an unbeatable man.
The thing that got me was he took the dude's move, but as soon as he low-blowed him, he was just cocky, obnoxious X-Pac chopping his crotch and just completely no-selling everything Jeff did. I thought it just completely dismissed Jeff. Like, if you're going to win, you can at least put over the fact that you almost got beat because you're a heel.
Yeah, just beat him here.
That all happened.
I was upset.
It was a lot of fun and could have been better.
Yeah.
The only thing I have to add is that the announcers noted Matt actually had a broken nose and cheekbone.
Wow.
That sucks.
Like, Jeff wasn't a great worker. I shouldn't say he wasn't a great worker. He was no Shawn Michaels or anything like that. But, like, he was in the right place for everything. All of his stuff looked good. He sells great. The fans love him. It's like, I realize he was kind of skinny. But, I mean, as we saw when he went to TNA, he's not a small guy. He's a tall fucking guy. He's just a little lanky. Like, you could have done more with the guy. Just had to beat him, have X-Pac beat him for no good reason.
So at the double date, people keep harassing Mark for autographs.
One of them says, and I quote, "How come you're such a loser, brother?"
After Mark gave him an autograph.
Yeah.
This guy needed his ass kicked. So he says this, he lost at the Olympics, he loses all the time on TV. Mark just laughs it off. Mark's a grown man, like the only mature person ever in wrestling. But he's there with Moolah and May, who are not mature, and they beat this guy's ass.
It was funny, because I, honest to God, when he says, "How come you're such a loser, brother?" I thought, man, we're going to have an acolyte situation here. Mark Henry and Harvey Whippleman are going to beat the shit out of these guys or something. And then it was the old ladies, which was, in fact, a welcome swerve. May's, actually, Moolah did all the violence. She tackles one of these guys.
She was going at it.
She was like a turtle that she couldn't get off her back.
Yes, that was tremendous. Help her up.
This was just ridiculous, but it was awesome.
Have either of you guys ever actually met Mark Henry in person?
Can't say that I have.
I don't think I have, no.
I guarantee you nobody called him a loser to his face.
Are you kidding me?
The closest I've come to meeting him was, there was a guy who used to work around here named Vince Hall for a long time. And he was very, very short and very, very skinny.
He's my height.
And even skinnier.
That short.
And he made his way to Ohio Valley, and they used him at an angle with Mark Henry, and being very, very familiar with Vince Hall, and seeing just how... Mark Henry blocked out the sun compared to him. So that was the point I realized, holy shit, Mark Henry's gigantic.
Yes.
That was my frame of reference. Kane versus Test. Okay.
Tori's out there in her bra and panties again.
It's just in her underwear for no reason.
Yeah, she wears clothes all over the place on this show. Until it's time to go to the ring, then she just takes all her clothes off.
Yes. So Test, if you've been watching the show, he's an innocent victim. He's been manipulated, and he's done nothing wrong except be... a little aggressive, I suppose, putting his arm around that woman backstage. But he certainly did not violate her, as she claimed. So he pleads his case. This is the case he makes in self-defense. It says, Kane, I never touched your woman. If you ask me, you need to give her some Prozac or Midol.
I'm sure that helped
so
ease the situation.
Test, the babyface, I guess... his response is to refer to Tori as Kane's property and then basically say she's just another crazy woman. This does not make me like Test at all.
No.
Kane beats the fuck out of him, shoves the ref down for the DQ because she's not here to win a match, and he hits a tombstone and Tori slaps Test in the face. Foley says goodbye to the refs and the Stooges. Big Show cuts a promo. Says, ever since Hunter has taken over, everything's been a game. He's put me through hell, putting me against challenger after challenger. Isn't that what a champion's supposed to do?
Yeah.
That's a strange line. But he's 7'2", he's 500 pounds, and it's going to be game over. I know I just made fun of that one line, but I thought this was a good promo.
I want to mention, by the way, going back to Kane versus Test, that Kane goes out there, he beats the shit out of Test. Test makes a short comeback, Kane beats the hell out of him again. Then shoves the ref for a DQ. Then beats the hell out of him again and tombstones him. Like, you had to protect Test. You know what I mean?
Like, this angle's not doing enough damage.
Like, if you're going to beat the shit out of the guy before, during, and after the match, I mean, just beat the fucking guy.
Well, you want to show that Kane is so angry he does not care about wins and losses.
Oh, I see, yeah. So, the history books. Okay, yeah, I got it. Yeah.
New Age Outlaws versus Too Cool. So Scotty's got that hat that he wears to the ring, and it gets knocked off right away, and they start wrestling, and this fucking hat's in the middle of the ring.
Yeah.
I'm terrified someone's gonna slip on this and break their neck.
A hat?
Stranger things have happened.
Well, we usually have like microphones in the middle of the ring and that sort of thing. This was just a hat.
So a thousand things happen at once here. Rikishi interferes. Grandmaster Sexy gets the skull-crushing finale and the leg drop, and X-Pac gets an X-Factor, and puts Road Dogg on top, and Road Dogg gets the pin, and then Rikishi powerbombs Road Dogg.
X-Pac won another fucking match here on the show.
He did. Rikishi hits a pile driver, hits the bonsai drop, and that's that.
So
he went for the bonsai drop.
Let's look at this a little closer. X-Pac beats Jeff Hardy clean in a match he didn't need to win. X-Pac wins this match for the Road Dogg and Billy Gunn. Then they're finally going to get their just desserts on X-Pac, and before he can get squashed, they yank his ass out of the ring and save him.
Right.
What photos did he have? What the fuck's going on here?
He's Hunter's friend.
This is fucking ridiculous. I'd also like to add that Too Cool, it's so fun to watch them evolve here. Because like a few weeks ago, they came out dancing. Nobody had any idea what to make of them. Then they added Rikishi, and when he started to dance, they just cut away. Now, the worm has been added, which, by the way, they're calling the centipede at this point. But, like, it's just at a random point during the match. It's not like one of his big moves yet. Mm-hmm. And now, the thing at the end of the match, people are getting into now. They're having Rikishi dance more. So, I'd like to see this. It's so great because it's so unlike what you see today. Like, today, if something starts to get over,
they bury it.
We got to fucking put an end to that.
Yeah.
But back then, it's like, fuck, this is getting over. Let's do it.
Do it more.
And they go for it. And it gets more over. I don't know what's happened to Vince.
This is one of those alternative universes things for me, like a different dimension. In my brain, Too Cool was over doing the dance number for quite a while. And then, like, Rikishi was just doing a run-in or something and was, like, a surprise, and he danced where they did the lights-out thing and got really over. It's like, he was with them, like, week one or two.
It was, like, week two.
This is not the way I remember it in my head.
Berenstain Bears.
I wonder if they were on heat a lot before Rikishi showed up.
It's possible.
It's possible.
Yeah, I don't know. So, Steph and Hunter are sick of Mick Foley saying goodbye. They tell him to leave and have cops there to lead Mick away.
No, because they debuted on Raw's Too Much.
That was a long time ago.
But it was like the next week they were with Rikishi, so I don't think they did anything on Heat first.
I don't know. So the end of the double date has Mark and May in bed. Mark has released his sexual tension or frustration, whatever he said. And then the big payoff is the camera pans over and Moolah's in bed with Harvey.
What was Harvey doing? He like sits up straight and he starts going, hey, 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 hey.
Fucking, that's what he was doing.
I guess. I was like, what are you doing?
That's Harvey Whippleman's afterglow.
Okay. That was weird.
Triple H walks backstage.
Yeah.
So we have Big Show versus Triple H.
Hunter's got his knee and his quad all taped up.
Yep.
Immediately takes that bump over the top that tore his pec this year.
So Hunter makes it no DQ, tells DX to stay on stage. So there's no interference or anything, he says. So the highlight of this match to me was Hunter calling spots just at the top of his lungs.
Oh my God, screaming.
Shouting to the back row.
Get up, Paul!
Get up, Paul! Which is funny because they're both Paul. Forearm! Side slam! Paul should have shouted back, okay, here I come! So of course, DX interferes a lot.
Yeah, I loved it because it's no DQ, but they don't interfere until the ref is bumped.
Yeah.
Who puts these matches together?
Well, they want to kill the illusion.
Oh, yeah.
So, Steph comes down. Everyone's getting chokeslammed. And Hunter hits a chair shot on the Big Show. But then there's Mick Foley, of all people, who hits Hunter with a chair. Big Show hits a chokeslam to the win. Huge ovation. The place is going crazy. This has been a terrible, terrible World Championship reign that I'd forgotten how awful it was. It was like the one good moment of Big Show's entire first championship run here. He came across as a star and a hero and a survivor and a conqueror.
I guess. I couldn't believe he left the year's champion. There you go. That's the show. I thought this was a pretty good show. It's slowly starting to turn around.
Yeah.
The Radicals are coming soon.
Bunch of meaningless matches. You remember that four-way tag and the mixed tags?
Oh, I remember that. At least they were meaningless for a minute.
Short meaningless.
Yeah, not like for 15 minutes like nowadays.
There was not a perfect show, but there was a good stuff for the show, and it definitely has a direction, which is important.
Your finishes, Vinny.
Sure thing. The finishes on this show were clean pin, fast count by a crooked ref, pin after interference, DQ did interference, win after interference and a pink slip on a pole match, apparently a clean pin and a mess of a four-corner tag match, more or less clean pin, I wrote. Not sure what that's in reference to. DQ due to attack on a referee, pin after interference in a mess of a tag match, and then pin after tons of interference in a no DQ match.
Excellent timing, Vinny. You get better every week.
I see, now you put pressure on me.
Yeah, you fuck it up next week.
I'm sure I will.
Have Rob read him next week.
That actually is a great idea.